Bling, bling. Pearl Jam to start the show. Thank you, Travis. Last night, I'm on Twitter, and this guy tweets me. He's like, hey, man, Pearl Jam in, where was it, Chile?
Chile.
On the Periscope. And I'm like, all right, I'll click this dumb thing and listen to Pearl Jam live in Chile, thinking the audio is going to be shitty. The audio was really, really good. So then I DM Travis, but you already were on it. So there you have it. It was nice.
Great. You sit in New York and you watch Pearl Jam in a different country.
Yeah, the video was shitty, but the audio was nice. And then I'm doing my stuff listening to live Pearl Jam. Ronnie's not impressed.
I thought I was waiting for my intro. I didn't know what was going to happen there. Yeah.
Ron Bennington, everybody.
I did not see that because... What time was this last night?
Around 8, I guess.
Okay, all night I was on the Periscope watching Jenny Hutt sleep. She's got a new thing, you know what I mean? Like, I'm going off to bed, everybody. Watch me. Very exciting. Now, when you were watching the Pearl Jam, did he get the long pants on yet, or is he still selling the short shorts?
No, he's moved past the long shorts.
See, I think that he should Freddie Mercury his whole act and just go shorter and shorter and shorter.
Just tiny, tiny shorts.
I don't know if you could rock with shorts on. I don't know whether it could be.
They
got
to be long. They got to be knee length. Anthrax wears them. A lot of metal bands wear them. They're okay to wear if they're knee length.
AC/DC rocks the shorts.
Yeah, Angus Young has done
that. He rocks the shorts.
That's the uniform. That's like John John. He's dressed like when John John was saluting his dad's casket when he went by. That's why every time I see AC/DC, I'll start crying. I'm just like thinking about what could have been. Camelot Lost, if you will.
He kind of looks ridiculous in his shorts now. That whole shorts thing with Angus jumped the shark.
Well, don't you think? I mean, I guess you could pull off the Kevin Smith shorts thing.
The long ones?
It's so long.
Yeah,
that it's you're almost like, okay, he just needs a little air on his ankles.
He wears a winter coat over shorts. Yeah. He'll wear like a long, like, Tennyson jacket over a pair of shorts. That's just, he doesn't like
I've never seen, there's something happened when he was a kid to his ankles. I don't know what it was.
He got beat.
Couldn't move with his ankles. So, You were watching the
this. Paris,
yeah. Now, you guys are big Pearl Jam's fans.
Travis more than me. I can't front.
Aren't every one of their shows available right after anyway? Can't you just
not anymore? They used to put them out like a week later, but now they really take their time. They wait for the tour to end.
And they think about it.
And then they put them all out.
And release them carefully instead of just throwing them all out.
Yeah,
there.
I don't think a band can have 850 albums out. I just don't think that's fair. After a while, enough, boys.
I listen to the Pearl Jam channel here on Sirius XM. But then I tap out because it's like it just seems to be the same shit over and over again.
No, it never gets old.
I wish the channel was called the first two Pearl Jam albums.
Really?
And then I would listen, yeah.
Oh, there's some good songs.
You just keep going and going. With them?
There's a song I love called Just Breathe.
Just breathe.
It's a slower number.
I like one song they do. A cover of I Believe in Miracles.
That's a good
that
one.
That I love. Anything else they do?
Don't have time for it.
I'm just busy.
I respect.
Very, very busy.
I respect the Pearl Jam. They never went away.
Who has?
Well, I mean, they felt like they went away, but they just continued to tour and they just like hammered it out. Kind of did the Grateful Dead thing for a while there.
But isn't that true of every band that you just keep touring?
Until
the end of time?
Yeah, I guess you're right.
As long as there's any money left on the table, a band will
squeeze it out.
Yeah, they will go out after it. I don't know one band that I would say, oh, they'll never get together again. Like when a band breaks up and they're like, oh, I go, yeah, sure they are.
Yeah.
Zeppelin.
Zeppelin is the only band, but I don't think Robert Plant can sing that anymore.
I think you're right.
That's the problem.
I'm not even sure he can sing it then. If I'm going to be totally honest, I'm like, you're pushing.
Oh, God, he can hit those notes.
The fucking song. That's the song I really despise. That whole
why immigrant song.
We come from the land of the ice and snow. No, you don't, dude. Stop with the fucking dragon rock.
That's my favorite Zeppelin. Don't ruin it. You're gonna make me hate it.
What if they? They're fucking pulling swords out of stones and shit. I like their rock stuff and their blues stuff, but the second
love their blues stuff.
Start to fucking sing about magical dwarves and shit.
But they started believing it because they all bought castles. They were living the dream.
English dudes do buy castles.
Old castles. Yeah,
there's not a lot of new ones. That's the thing.
I don't know about that. I wonder if they still build castles.
There are many mansions. It's like what Tony Soprano lived in. Yeah. That's what they build now. But all those guys, Keith Richards moved into one and all, because no one had ever moved up in weight class in, you know, England. No one ever was like, went from working class to rich. Mm. So they're like, all right, we have money. What do rich people do?
Right.
They live in castles. And they're like, fuck, now we're not around anybody anymore.
Yeah, but that's, you know? Yeah. And that's when the band starts suffering, right?
Yeah, you're far away from the clubs. You don't know what to do out there.
Mm-hmm. You got to try to get the guys together to record new music.
You have fucking servants asking you about, steer and shit. And you're like, I don't know.
And then one guy gets the idea, let's just do it in my castle. You set up your drum set in the foyer.
In the foyer of the castle.
And we'll put the bassist in the dungeon. They wire the whole house.
But the maid in the band. This fucking yeah. maid is drumming after a while.
Yeah, they always have some amazing story about how the record came together.
Right.
Like, we were all in these different rooms, and then the maid had a miscarriage on the steps, and I'm like, let's open the album with that.
That's her losing the baby.
Yeah, well, they say acoustically, the foyer's the best for the drums.
Is that right?
Oh, God, I forgot what book it was in. It might have been Keith Richards.
We ought to then just put a radio studio in the foyer.
I would like that. That would be wonderful.
Didn't Jimmy Page have some young girl in a fucking castle or something? He was banging some underage girl for a long time? Or
No, there was a story yesterday. This girl said she did this thing. The name of the article was David Bowie Took My Virginity. And then David Bowie gave her to Jimmy Page. She was 15. Uh-huh. And then all those girls, like, if you go back into the 70s, they all banged
young
underage girls.
Right.
There's a fucking Alice Cooper documentary.
Saw it.
That's so great. And he's at the Hollywood Bowl, and he just reaches over, and he's just making out with this child.
Yeah.
Literally grabs a child and just starts making out, and you're just like, wow.
Yeah, they just...
Things were fucking nuts in 74.
They just looked the other way. They all were pushing the laws back then.
I don't think there was even... I don't even know, were the laws in the books?
I don't know. That's a good question.
The
70s
were fucking crazy with that.
I don't think you could fuck young girls, though.
No, I think there was so much going on in the 70s that, like, well, we'll get to that.
We can't find gas right now.
We
cannot find gas. Yeah. I don't care who banged that kid.
I'll go to that hotel, but I got to fill up first. It's going to take me 5 hours.
But back then, the college professors also used to bang the students. And that fucking, all that shit changed as soon as college got expensive. You know what I mean? As soon as some fucking father said, look, I'm not paying $45,000 a year for you to fuck my kid. This is ridiculous. Right. This is stupid now.
When it was a good $2,000.
Yeah,
okay.
When it was like that, the kid got the, found some pop bottles, went to college on their own,
Well, Animal House, they were all partying with
Yeah, Animal House.
Donald Sutherland.
Yeah.
They were all getting high.
And no one, and he banked. Karen Allen in that.
No one thought it was bad.
No one thought, oh, this is awful.
Yeah, no. It was cool.
If you would have showed Animal House now when that scene came up, you just heard this in the theater. Well, how people would just be freaked. Oh, my God.
Well, the one, Back to the Future was hot 2 weeks ago. That scene, I can't even believe it was in a movie ever. When Biff is basically date raping the mom there in the car. He's raping her. And this is looked at as a family movie.
Yes, but you have to remember it was a date rape.
Date rape.
Yeah.
We all kind of understood the date rape thing is what you're saying. Is that what you're saying? Going back to the 70s.
The only people that actually even use
that
word.
Why are we laughing at that? That's horrible.
Are men. Right. Only men say date rape.
Right. But it wasn't even a thing when we were growing up. There was nothing called date
rape.
Look,
you're going to fucking date Catholic girls, you know what I mean? It's not easy.
I hear you. I hear you.
God, you could say it. What happened? What happened out there on Long Island?
I didn't get anything done out there on Long Island. That's the problem. I was a late bloomer. There's the scene, though, man. That was a rape scene.
Yeah. There was rape scenes in a lot of the 80s comedy.
Crazy.
What was the Molly Ringwald one where... The nerd is Anthony Michael Hall fucks the really hot one and she's drunk in the car.
Hey
man, make sure she gets, who are you? Who's he? It's me.
Right.
Yeah. And then he just basically takes her home and fucks her when she's drunk and she's like, oh my god, that was great. Or Revenge of the Nerds.
Right. Yeah. She decides she liked it after the fact.
After the fact. Stuck it in and fucked like a nerd does. Yeah. She enjoyed it.
She thought it was her boyfriend at the time.
Yeah.
These scenes they would not make in comedies.
It would end with just a guy being carted off to prison.
Yeah. Yeah. Handcuffed.
Revenge of the Nerds. He puts on the Darth Vader mask and he fucks the guy's girlfriend.
Yeah. But even in every 80s movie, there's some scene where someone rips a top off a girl and her fucking giant titties are just bouncing.
And then a crowd cheers.
I remember being in theater. Everybody was like, yay!
It was the cheap thrill.
Yeah,
I've talked about that. That went away in movies. Every movie had to have the tit shot, and it would never make sense as far as the movie went.
I mean, even Vacation. Remember, the mom's tits were out in Vacation, which is a children's movie, really.
Yes. I don't remember that.
Yeah, she's in the shower, and he just rips open the thing, and she's like, oh Clark.
Ooh. Well, she had nice ones, though. You have to show those off.
Wasn't Pacino with her, Beverly D'Angelo?
Yes, they had twins.
Yeah, he can't pick them out of a lineup. You'll be the first one, and I'm going to say four.
I'm going to say number two and number three. Oh, no.
The tit shots in the openings, I remember in Dressed to Kill, one of the sexiest things I've ever seen was the movie Dressed to Kill with Angie Dickinson, that opening shower scene with her, just washing those big fat tits. Nancy Allen. Oh, wonderful.
Nancy Allen was fucking amazing, right?
Yeah. Who was she banging? Was it Brian De Palma?
Brian De Palma. Her husband. That's how she got in movies, and they divorced, and you never saw her again.
Never heard from her again.
Goodbye. I want to see Beverly D'Angelo's boobs. I'm trying to remember this scene.
It was just
with his camcorder, right? Yeah.
Oh, Clark!
Oh, you got the TV version because you're on YouTube.
Before we go away, honey. Come on.
Oh, you gotta go to Mr. Skin.
Look at the size of the JVC he's got.
Let's go to Mr. Skin.
It's like he's coming in with a refrigerator.
Right.
Look at the size of that. Right. I had a fucking telephone that big.
It doesn't seem too long ago. That's the scary part. And now it's all right here.
I know. Well, even when you watch Seinfeld, like you're just watching it, it seems like a show, and then suddenly he picks up his fucking phone. It's
his giant phone. There you go. Wow.
Yeah, those are nice.
Those are lovely.
She had a twin on each one. Just fucking suckling away.
Is that before or after?
No, that was before.
That was before. Wow.
Is he still married to her?
No.
That's long gone.
No, he can't come in within 50 yards of the fucking family.
We saw, what was her name? Lacey Underall from, she's thinking of big heavy tits. You remember her?
Yeah.
I still heard a signing with Sam when I was at Comic-Con. And she said she's not, doesn't look quite the same. Yes, she used to.
She just was nipping out through her shirt. I don't think she showed in that movie, did she?
Oh, yeah, she did.
Yeah, she did. Where? What scene?
When,
in the pool, right? No?
Go to Mr. Skin.
At Judge Smale's house.
I don't remember.
Yeah, Danny had sex with her.
Yeah, but did they actually show?
Oh, yeah.
They showed the titty.
Oh,
the titty. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is our youth, man. These comedies with the tit shots.
Remember?
Oh, all right. There you go.
Remember the Irish girl in Caddyshack?
With the horrible accent.
She was in Animal House and basically drunk, fucking tits out.
She was the 15-year-old.
Yeah.
With the padded bra. Remember? He pulls it off and it's all, what?
Toilet paper and stuff.
And she was
under shit, but it was toilet paper.
That's another one where it was underage sex.
Yeah.
What happened to her? I never saw her again.
She did Caddyshack after that, and that was about it. Right? I don't remember her ever being in anything else.
Yeah, I think she turned in...
Tanks for nothing.
I think she had some trouble after that.
Did she?
Yeah.
What, with getting gigs or the personal life?
No. The smoking a glass cock, I believe, was the story I heard.
Really?
Yeah.
Speaking of trouble, you remember that movie Ladybug? With Rodney Dangerfield. I know this is very obscure. But the kid that played in that and had to dress up like a girl.
Jonathan Brandis.
You know that Jeez, fucking that guy hung himself?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
In the movie? Oh, no, I'm thinking Wizard of Oz.
Yeah. I believe that. In the background, right? In the woods? It happened. Supposedly somebody hung themselves on set and they didn't pick up on it until after the movie was made.
It was like an ostrich or something.
Yeah, it was a bird.
It turned out to be a bird?
Yeah.
blown up my spot.
What, do you want to believe these things forever?
Yes, I do.
He's boyish. He likes these boyish curiosities.
Feel like the older brother who did a Santa Claus remark, and now I ruined his childhood.
Here's the kid. He's dead. He hung himself. I didn't know that. He was a big deal for a few years.
What else did he do since
years?
E-Rock knows his name off the top of his head?
I've really never heard a name come out faster.
I know.
There's no way he could have been ready for a Ladybugs reference.
He was in...
In the meantime, he's never heard of George Harrison.
He's in the Beach Boys.
His last movie was Heart's War with Bruce Willis, and his part was being cut down to where he was only on screen for maybe 2 minutes, and he thought the part was going to be bigger, and that sent him over the edge. And weeks after that movie, he killed himself. He hung himself.
Was it because he was down to 2 minutes, or because he was still had to be in that movie for 2 minutes?
Yeah. Bruce Willis did him a favor in the end. No one saw Heart's War.
He was in like a Spielberg TV show that was.
He was in everything
underwater.
For a while. He was huge. Oh, he was in Sequest. Was it called Sequest? Yeah, Sequest. Okay, yeah, he was a big deal.
I didn't realize I met that kid years ago back then. Because that cast came in when I was in Florida.
For real?
Yeah, and I as soon as you said that thing, I remember now. They were all underwater. Yeah. It only lasted like 8 episodes.
Roy Scheider was on that show.
Oh yeah, he was the captain of the underwater adventure show.
He was in It. I never saw the Bill Denbrough, the stutterer. I remember from the book. I never actually saw the movie.
I didn't know he fucking killed himself. I didn't know he hung himself.
Does he know how many people get cut out of movies? Does he know it's fairly common?
Certainly is.
Yeah. I never should have said that in front of
Jimmy.
Oh, no,
but I handled it properly. I only thought of that.
they said he had a boyish face, and he wasn't going to get better roles, because they all looked at him like he was just a kid still.
None of us are getting roles, so what's the big deal?
Just relax. Our lives are okay.
Yeah.
Go find a radio show.
Yeah,
you'll be
most
all right.
Most people do not have this wonderful movie career. About 6 billion of us on the planet.
So we shouldn't feel sorry for him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what to say. It's always I stop getting roles.
Right.
Then you're like everyone else.
You had a wonderful life. Enjoy that part of it.
If you get a big movie role, you should be talking about that forever.
One would be nice.
Yeah.
I'll take one.
There's a guy got cut out of Full Metal Jacket, a character, Captain January. Is that didn't Matthew Modine talk about that? He had an amazing part in the thing, and Kubrick just, for some reason, didn't think the character was needed.
Right.
And dropped the whole fucking character out of a classic film.
Wow.
There's people that got cut out of The Godfather. I don't know who.
Yeah.
But there's somebody that got cut out of that. There's somebody that got cut out of On the Waterfront.
Kevin Costner was cut out of Big Chill.
Big Chill. With that one, Ronnie. He was the corpse still, though.
How long do I got to wait? How long?
My timing's not as quick as yours, but I'm there. But he was the corpse. He was still the corpse in the movie.
Well, but they never showed his face, right?
Right, no.
Just his cut wrist.
He was completely cut out of that movie, though. You're right.
I don't remember what that was about.
Big Chill?
It was about, like, these people are in this place and start to get really cold.
I thought it was that. Yeah, and some guy with sweaters is the hero. I thought so.
Yes. And everyone was like, is he going to get here? Or what are they going to do? But now this was the one that they were, like, college friends, and then one of their friends killed themselves. They hadn't seen each other in years. And then they all came back together for the fucking funeral.
Right, okay. And realized why they haven't seen each other in years.
Because
they start getting cunty toward each other.
Right.
That's the whole movie.
Yeah.
It's a very white movie.
What do you mean white?
You mean it's righteous and good.
It's white. You know what I mean?
Just because the cast is white?
Yeah, just...
Glenn Close was
black
in
people
that.
I think it appeals to a certain demographic only.
Is that Cindy Williams?
Well,
Jeff Goldblum was in this movie.
Ali Sheedy? I was looking at the movie poster.
Ali Sheedy was in this movie.
Is that her? No.
Kevin Kline.
No. Oh, no, that was the other one that looked like Ali Sheedy, but wasn't Ali Sheedy.
That's what I wanted. You know how many times I've said that?
She was the one that kind of had the Ali Sheedy roles, but she wasn't Ali Sheedy. She was in a couple things.
Meg Tilly? No.
Yeah, it's Meg Tilly.
Meg Tilly. Okay, you're right. Kevin Kline, that's right. William Hurt was in this movie.
Tom Berenger. Wow, I really have no memory of this movie.
It's really the reason why in every chick flick, there is some scene where everyone's dancing in the kitchen to Motown.
Yep.
They were the first ones to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, we're doing the dishes and we're listening to Motown and we're having fun because life is great.
Yeah.
And you see that scene like 900 times. It's a very white. I like to say it's a white thing to do.
Yeah, see? I agree with you.
I like Ronnie. I think Ronnie's right.
Ronnie's onto something.
Ronnie's onto something.
What about
Jamie Gillis is the preacher. That's not the same Jamie Gillis from porn, is it?
Once in a while, these guys show up. Jamie Gillis from porn.
I don't know. Probably not. But once in a while, you'll see like a porn person show up. And like in 52 Pickup, you see how Roy Scheider and Ann Margaret, like Ron Jeremy and Amberlynn are in like a jacuzzi scene. I love seeing porn people in real movies.
Let's go to Irish J. Irish J, what's up? We got Ron Bennington in studio today.
Yeah, I'm really happy to be calling in and talking to you guys. Thanks for taking the call.
Right.
Tried to call yesterday, couldn't get through. My heart was woken.
Stop with the exposition. Get to it. You know, it's funny. It's colder here than I thought it would be. Shut up, Jay.
I really do. I do want his backstory, though, Jimmy. I'm trying to put everything together from my part.
Get to it, bro.
I was wondering two quick things. I was wondering if you ever saw the ghost in Three Men and a Baby.
Yeah, that's a ghost. Ron, that's a ghost.
Yeah, Opie, that's a ghost. It's a real ghost sitting there. A little boy died there.
What the hell was it? It was a cutout or something, right?
It was a dead child.
Right.
What else?
Did you ever see the set of tits in The Rescuers? There's a photograph of that, the Disney movie, The Rescuers. There's actually a photograph of a woman's tits in that film.
All right. The ghost thing is fucking strange, because they're trying to say it was a Ted Danson cutout. I don't believe that.
I don't know where you mean.
But you would rather believe it's a dead kid?
No, I know it's not a dead kid. But I want the real explanation, because they try to say it was a Ted Danson cutout.
That's a live baby. She's holding it right there.
No, that baby died days before.
But they had already paid it, and they're like, we're not paying another one. I understand.
Where's the ghost boy in Three Men and a Baby?
Oh, my God. I found the naked...
Oh, you did find that?
Yeah.
Wait, hold on. Let's get to the end of this. Yeah. When does the ghost boy show up?
He's
in
a window somewhere.
Left.
He's like
right there.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a...
What the fuck is that?
It's a dead kid.
Yeah, it's definitely a dead kid. The soul of a dead
the
kid.
The soul. I mean, the body is
somebody
else.
Brought their kid to set.
Well, the ghost...
And they didn't realize that the kid was taking a peek.
The ghost haunted that apartment. It's not a set.
Yeah.
That's where the kid...
It's a set if you're using it for a movie. I don't care that it started out as someone's apartment.
Kid was smothered there.
It's a movie set.
It's not a ghost.
It's not a ghost.
That
boy.
Kid had been cut out of another movie and hung himself.
Yeah.
Sad. Sad, really.
Yeah, God, it is sad. Look who's talking to. Yeah.
Look who's choking. Which was so much fun.
Three men and a ghost on a trip, blah, blah, blah. See, they're saying it's false. Of course it's false. It's not a ghost.
But they don't want people to panic.
Where's the tip shot?
Who needed that proof, though? Somebody actually said, I want proof that's not a real ghost.
But what's the real explanation? Was it a kid on set that day?
It was a cutout. It's flat.
They're saying it's this cutout that they're
showing. Ted Danson.
Yeah,
that's what I've heard over the years, but it doesn't look like that.
Look, it's flat behind the curtain.
There it is right there.
Yeah, where's the hat part?
It's black against the wall there.
Yeah. I don't know if that's whatever. Yeah. Fine.
One looks like a reverse dead kid. Image.
It's I'll go with ghost
boy. The kid killed himself in that apartment.
You found the tit thing, though?
It's so sad.
I just sent it.
What's the tit thing again?
From the cartoon The Rescuers, the Disney cartoon The Rescuers.
Well, but Disney's known for doing that shit.
Yeah, they did something like that.
They squeeze some weird stuff in their movies. Oh, wow, look at that. Oh, that's hilarious.
I can't even see it blown up.
But that's one frame. If you were actually watching that movie, you would never see that.
It's too small.
And Disney would do this just to kind of make themselves laugh. And then, you know, the technology changed and then people started picking up on this shit.
They actually recalled the movie?
Who noticed that? Who's watching that so closely that they noticed a one frame?
It's like Fight Club. It's stuck in your head.
You think so?
Yeah.
Like drink Coke during the fucking...
You're like, yeah, I will. We shot a movie when I was in high school. And we had read about, I forget what the term is for that subliminal something. It's subliminal.
Message!
It's just called subliminal advertising.
We had shot this thing. We were just like shooting. And then we did a close-up of my friend's cock, right? And like we had never even, and then we went into the next scene.
Yeah.
And we had never really... edited or whatever, we just got it back and started playing it in the classroom. And so you just see like people walking down the hall and then a close up of a cock that was probably 8 fucking seconds long.
You didn't do it properly.
Then,
no. You're supposed to do it for
and
like,
then back into the other thing.
It's supposed
and we're
to be
like,
this
did
quick.
Anyone catch that?
It's supposed to be like that.
Yeah.
That's funny. Go to subliminal advertising. They put it in the ice cubes.
Yeah. Right.
They put a lot of penises and tits in ice cubes.
And
the letters S-E-X.
Yeah.
Oddly, so do I. Isn't that weird? When you,
you do.
They do the same thing as these marketing geniuses.
In Clockwork Orange, there's a scene. Remember when he smashes her in the face with the giant dick? He kills the...
Yeah.
When you watch that, that's like a really weird cartoon image. And when you freeze frame it, they're all different sexual paintings. That was never supposed to be freeze frame. That was supposed to just be like a fraction of a second.
But that's fucking Kubrick.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just very, very... just kind of gets in there.
Yeah, he does. Subliminal advertising. You can look it up yourself. But they love fooling around with the ice cubes, especially. They make it look like orgies and stuff.
There has to be some reason people are drinking Coke after all these fucking years. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Right.
You ever not drank Coke for a while and then drink it and you're like, it burns! It fucking burns so bad!
I'm not a big soda guy. I never have been.
This is the one from...
Which one is that?
This is from a book called Subliminal Seduction.
Is that a girl?
Yeah, out the S.
There's her ass.
An E... And there's an X.
Oh, I thought that was her fucking ass, but you're saying it's an S.
Where the hell is sex?
S.
Oh.
They got to be careful how they do it, I guess.
Oh, I don't know. I would never have caught that. Even subliminally, my brain would fucking ignore that.
It would just be mush.
A fucking E in the ice. Terrible.
Now they're saying Jonathan Brandis killed himself after he was cut from Black Hawk Down.
Oh, I get that. All right.
Yeah. I heard it was because...
I thought he was miscast as a Somalian.
I heard it was because of the Bruce Willis movie. See, look, there you go. A there dick and a mouth. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Real live lesbian.
Oh, I thought you were looking at my iPhone.
Like a penis. What's the lesbian part if that's a penis and a mouth?
Look, here's another one where it's a girl's penis sex in there.
Yeah, there's the sex. They love doing that in the ice cubes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I guess
I don't even know if it works, though. Is that just work or is that just a fun thing advertisers do that they think is cool?
I think they're so bored with their jobs, they do it just to make each other laugh. And then someone decided, it's subliminal advertising.
To show their friends. Like, look at this. Yeah. I put a clit in this, of course. This, you know, ad for Clark Bars.
This is a good one.
Oh, wow. That is a good one.
Watch. So there's I'll put this up on the Twitter page, but there's a woman who's holding up a glass, but if you turn it upside down,
she's diddling her twat. Oh, but I mean,
that's pretty good. I'll say that's pretty good.
Yeah, but you got to turn it upside down. And...
Yeah.
Wow.
So bats complained.
But if I would have found that when I was a kid, forget about it. I'd have fucking called 8 friends and started a fort.
Tom Papa now in
Tom
studio.
Papa.
Good morning, everybody.
Home to Papa.
Hi, guys.
Hey, buddy.
We're talking about subliminal advertising.
Largo's own. Tom Papa.
Yes. Ooh. You know, we're...
go back to that one on the
sneaky
top.
Sneaky stuff.
There's one
sneaky,
of
sneaky, sneaky.
It's a light switch. That's not subliminal. It looks like she's touching her pussy.
Ew.
Oh, there's the mouse thing that looks like a clit.
Oh, it's a mouse. I see. Yeah. That,
a mouse
that
looks like a clit.
No one operates on a flesh-colored desk. It's supposed to be her legs.
But that's how they're trying to sell their
look
mouse.
Look at the slug line. Using this computer is like playing with a cunt. You know what I mean? Like, it's good. That's good stuff.
A little on the nose, but...
Leaving a little to the imagination. That's good for them. there's a subliminal scene in The Exorcist. This I got to take. Let's say hi to Boomer in Atlanta. Boomer.
Good morning, gents.
Good morning. Get right to it. We got a good energy going here. Let's keep it up.
There's a scene in The Exorcist about two-thirds of the way through where the priest is having some type of dream sequence and the movie is really slow.
With his mother. It's a very, very creepy scene.
And he comes up out of the subway and up onto the sidewalk. And a demon's face appears just brilliantly for like a second and a half or so.
I wouldn't say that's subliminal, though. There's that creepy demon. That was actually a woman in makeup, that demon. You know the moment?
I don't really know the scene. I haven't seen it in many, many years.
I don't remember.
Yeah, so you can find that. It's it's a demon that flashes quickly as in the middle of Damien's dream. She comes up somewhere else in this... movie too.
First time I watched The Exorcist, I had a fever. My parents just left me with the TV, and The Exorcist was on.
Oh my God.
As a kid, and I, for like 2-3 weeks, just slept on my sister's floor. I couldn't.
Why didn't you change the channel?
I had a fever. I didn't know what was going on. I'm like, Mom, put the show on for me.
I mean, just put the TV on to babysit you, and it's The Exorcist.
There's a devil in me.
That's hilarious.
Again, would they even make that movie with that kid
no.
today?
No, no, no way.
You know,
way.
We were talking about that earlier.
No way.
About what they did with kids back then. Pretty Baby was another one with Brooke Shields, where she played a prostitute, and she was like 11 or something.
Yeah. Well, you Blue Lagoon.
Right.
Yeah, Blue Lagoon.
At least, they were, at least they were the same age in that one.
Yeah, but the audience wasn't.
Bunch of old men.
Yeah, tell that to all those dicks out in the front row. Where Jodie Foster, a taxi driver.
Sure.
Playing a young
prostitute.
Plus the language in The Exorcist, let Jesus fuck you. All these filthy things she had to say.
Yeah.
That's probably what the problem
They just would not make that movie today. That's too bad.
Yeah, the church would lose it today.
We're better off. It was scary.
Yeah, it was a scary fucking movie, man.
It was so scary.
It was. You know what? When you're down in Georgetown in D.C., you can pull up.
The stairs?
And those fucking stairs are there.
I've done it.
And I've done it, and I was like, I wouldn't go up those stairs.
Isn't it any,
you got to go up the stairs.
Isn't it a gas station? They come down into the parking lot of a gas station.
Is that right?
And the house, like when, in the movie, Damien falls out the window, jumps out the window. But in real life, the house is set back a little farther, and you realize that would have been incredible jump, but the steps still look
and the house is right there too.
A lot of people don't want to put their house right on a cliff though, do they? They're like that close.
And when you have the devil directing your movie,
right,
you can do it.
Tom,
isn't it true?
No, it's not.
That's so the scary. Fever. That's the so fever.
You still got the fever.
Oh, so scary.
Yeah. Got the fever.
Oh, I felt it. Like it was inside me.
How old were you?
I don't know. 11.
Oh God, that's horrendous.
Oh.
You're a little old to be feeling that way.
Still, you mean?
No, I mean 11. That's a little bit like.
I was a gentle child.
I saw it and I had a rash and it didn't bother me. Bad, you know what I mean?
Yeah, the fever's different.
Yeah, different illnesses. Yeah, you know.
You grew up quicker
itchy.
Though.
Yeah.
Down there in Philly, they grow up a lot faster. A lot faster.
Why? What did you find out, Ope? What happened?
Philly is a tough fucking town, is what I've found out over the years. Oh, I told you before the show, the Halloween candy had to be thrown away. They had problems down there this year.
The little pins in it. I heard you talking about that the other day.
No, but one, the area we were trick-or-treating in, the next town over, which is a little sketchier, I will say. One of the lollipops was tainted, and a kid went to the hospital. So
we tainted had a, with what?
We had to dump a whole
tainted
fucking...
Love.
Tainted love.
Yeah,
soft cell. So we had to dump all our candy.
A little drugs?
I don't know what
baby
it was,
drugs.
But
it's like
similar.
The kid's fine in the end, but they had to rush her to the emergency room.
That only happens.
So
there.
The whole neighborhood just dumped the candy.
Are you sure? Are you sure that that's the actual lollipop? And it wasn't something else. They're just blaming on the lollipop.
Right. Who knows? But when you have two little kids, you just say fuck it. And you don't take the
candy. Just buy him the shit.
Let's go buy some
I'll just
candy.
Go. Right. It's so like, we'll go buy him some candy.
It's like $10 worth. You're walking around all night for $10. It's like everyone's giving you 8 cents a piece. I know when I was a kid at Halloween, there was a guy in our neighborhood and he was giving out razors, but he had put an apple in it. So when you went to shave, it was, oh God, it was awful.
It was mealy and uncomfortable.
It was terrible. Made the radio. Didn't make it to TV. But AM radio stayed on it pretty hard.
They were giving out pretzels this Halloween.
Soft pretzels?
Soft pretzels.
And mustard?
My kid got two of them. Like,
let me put a little mustard on that for you.
He's just dumping soft pretzels in his bag. I'm just laughing my ass off. It brought me back when we used to get the cookies. Remember there was always one lady that just would drop a cookie in there?
Lame house.
Yeah.
With no packaging. It would just... She made chocolate chip cookies.
Just throw them at her window.
Right.
Those were more innocent times.
I got my candy stolen once. We were all sitting around. This is when I was like a little older, so I did the pillowcase thing and not like the fucking pumpkin head carry bag. And we were sitting there, and some just kids ran by and just snatch, and then
ouch,
kept going. I think his friends yelled at him and got the candy back, but it was really humiliating.
Yeah.
At the end of the night, to have your candy taken by a bigger boy. You realize how vulnerable you are when your candy is stolen. There's nothing I could do about it.
So sad.
You're like when you're a kid, you're like just like a tiny fish in the ocean. You know? Like anything can fucking happen to you when you leave the house.
Right.
Whoa, there's the evil face. Is that supposed to just be in the movie though?
Yeah. Okay. It happens a couple of times. It's not subliminal. It's just a quick flash.
Yeah. I don't think that's subliminal.
No, it's not. It's just a quick flash.
Yeah, we were talking about subliminal, and then they point us to The Exorcist with the first demon face.
It's a terrifying moment, though, when you're watching the movie, because it's kind of silent.
I'm always fucking frightened.
He's dreaming, and he's trying to stop his mother from coming up the steps.
Fuck but that. You know what? If you try to show it to kids now, they can't. It's so slow-moving.
Yeah,
right.
You know, story. It takes forever to get there. And I remember when my kids, I'm like, hey, I'm going to scare the shit out. We're going to watch The Exorcist. And they're like 45 minutes in, they're like, what the fuck is this? Yeah. This sucks.
Yeah, 13-year-olds are going, why is Lee J. Cobb in this movie?
I watched the remake of Poltergeist with my daughter the other day, like before Halloween. Mm. I thought it was the original, which I was psyched for, and I was like, oh, it's the remake.
How was that?
It was good. But it definitely was like updated and moved quicker. But it didn't suck. Like it was. Oh, this should move at this pace now.
Yeah.
It was pretty. Sam Rockwell was in it.
I had no desire to see the remake.
It was pretty.
I might
good.
Have to check it out.
They
now.
Did a good job.
The Evil Dead remake was good. I was surprised how frightening that was. It was like sometimes the remakes don't suck.
Yeah. No. I know this one was. It was still scary.
The original's pretty funny.
I slept on my sister's floor for like 2 weeks.
I don't think so. It's still there. Why don't you just move your mattress in there? But here's the thing about Poltergeist. That was the first time that something scary happened, like in a non-scary house. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you saw that movie. It looked like your neighborhood. It was just the suburbs.
Yeah.
You know, because before that, you were like, why would anyone fucking move into that house?
A big spooky house.
Yeah.
Cobwebs on it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say it was the first horror in a non-scary house. Patch of Blue.
That's a good point, though.
Yeah.
You're right.
You removed the headstones, but you left the bodies, didn't you?
But you left the bodies.
You left the bodies.
Well, the other great thing they have, remember, like, they just showed that there was a tree outside, and it was fucking scary, and every kid has looked out his window when he was little and just seen, like, a winter tree.
Yeah.
And I'm like, fuck.
Yeah.
That's the other thing that they did. They all the stuff that you were waiting for, they brought out early.
Yeah.
They brought out the line about the headstones, the tree, like, with the first 10 minutes is like attacking the kid. There were clowns all over the place. A shitload of clowns just attacked him his first night in the house.
They know kids just don't have patience, so let's throw all this shit at him immediately.
And also the parent, like, for us watching it, is like, oh, they're going to get to that part. It's like, no, here it all is. Now we're going to scare you with some new shit.
Oh, they went new shit.
Yeah, it was pretty nice. Good.
Sam Rockwell was dancing.
Yes, like a pretty pony.
Sopranos had big pussy in the mirror after he was killed. Well, that's not subliminal.
No.
It's not subliminal.
We were talking subliminal.
Do they still do a lot of subliminal imprints and stuff now, or is it...
I don't know.
I think it's illegal. I think it is. Yeah.
They finally said enough with the dicks and the ass and the tits in your commercials. Enough already.
Illegal because it's so effective?
Yeah.
They were sneaking this past. We think that, you know, they were just bored when they were putting this stuff together and they were doing it to make each other laugh. And then all of a sudden people were like, no, it's actually to make you buy the product.
Right.
I don't believe it.
I had heard that years ago. And then driving, they would do that with it just to drink Coke. That's probably illegal to flash an image.
Right.
To get you to purchase a product. The Ring scared the fuck out of me.
The Ring?
That movie scared. Stupid Keith Robinson burned me a copy of that in 2002 or 2003.
Yeah.
I literally couldn't fucking sleep with the lights off. I was a grown man. I was in my apartment on 43rd Street. I had to fucking sleep with the lights on.
Wow.
The first time in my adult life, the only time in my adult life.
That's
she was horrifying.
A friend of mine just said that. I was going to put on a movie during our Halloween party, just to like run in the background. And I went to put the Ring on. She's like, don't. Please don't. And what's the matter? She goes, you don't understand that movie messed with my head. I can't, please. I was like, I put it on. She's like, will you please get it off?
It's a really scary film.
She
probably just got divorced and she won't hear anything with Ring in it. Oh, Jim, the wordplay stuff. Back after this, gang.
Yeah, fuck that. I don't like scary movies in general.
I love being horrified. You're paying to feel something. It's so nice to actually have it work.
Yeah. Do you think that's The Ring scarier than The Shining?
I don't know.
I like The Shining. That's all right.
Yeah.
That's all right.
I just like the way he handled his marital difficulties.
Yeah.
That was disturbing.
Pirates of the Caribbean. What are they trying to say here, Eric?
They're trying to say that the logo on the poster is the
They're basically
Mickey
saying,
Mouse logo.
Fuck Mickey.
No, it is. It's a Disney
movie. It's made by Disney.
Yeah, but Mickey's on fire, though.
No, but they're.
So I think they're saying, fuck Mickey. Let's burn him alive.
No,
that's what I say.
Their own company. No. Yeah, but I think it's quite the opposite.
But his ears are on fire
And it's a skeleton.
They want you to think of Mickey.
That's a skeleton of Mickey, and then they burned him alive. I get it. Amazon, what are they
trying? The Amazon logo.
That's a penis?
Yes.
Yeah. What about the Starbucks logo?
It's not a penis. Which one?
Starbucks.
That's a pretty
good one. With that weird.
With the woman spreading her legs.
With the weird mermaid thing.
That's weird. Those are her arms.
No, her arms are here. She's holding up her legs.
What? She's holding up her fish legs.
No one sees that. Where's the legs?
The fish
going
legs.
Going up on the other side. That's the legs.
Oh, that's stupid.
And you look in her crotch, there's Mickey Mouse.
On fire. You know what? You say that's stupid, yet every single one of us has Starbucks in here today. You know, do the math.
I'm addicted.
That's true. I mean, I do like a cup of Starbucks.
I'm not wrong.
Can't sue him for slander.
that's not her legs. That's dumb.
Yeah. It is her legs.
I don't know what that is.
It used to be bigger. They cut it down. After there was a story about that. And then they had to kind of blow up the image a little bit.
Oh.
Why? Why don't they just say, fuck you? That's not what we were doing. Why are they caving?
I think you're right.
Why are they caving to that
shit? I work here. I don't know. I don't know why.
Yeah, she's holding them back, and you're on top of her.
It was actually a religious thing, because her feet represent cloven hooves. And that was the religious group objected to it.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Ooh, hoovesies.
Oh. Yeah.
Remember doing the Land O'Lakes thing when you were a kid?
Yeah.
What was that again?
I just taught my daughter that. She thought it was the greatest thing.
And you make it into
tits, you take the Land O'Lakes and you fold it twice.
Yeah.
And her knees become her tits.
Okay, yeah. We absolutely did this.
Oh, what a perfect little gem.
We were born in the suburbs.
Oh, she laughed. She was really, really, she really was like, holy shit.
Would it be funny if you heard her walk into the next room and she's on the phone and she's like, I can't believe it. I thought my dad was a fag all these years.
Good news.
But who figured that out the first time?
Anybody who had a Mad magazine?
Yeah.
Good point. Although the knees look like,
they look perfect.
They look like perfect boobs before you even fold them up.
Folded up they do, but
when they're folded up and go up, it is the perfect set.
Yeah.
Let's do the fold up.
Nice, heavy, fucking elongated tits.
Let's see.
They're perfect boobers.
Now she's just presenting her boobs.
Well, that's a cutout.
He
cut them out. Look how he cut them off.
Wow.
He went lazy.
Do you think that was done on purpose? It had to be. Yeah, because they look like nipples on the knees. There's no way that's what it
was. Yes. Those are nice bosoms.
The areolas.
Even the logo itself is kind of offensive in this day, right? With having the squaw, an Indian squaw from some company that Indians work there at all?
Nah. Nah.
You're fine with it?
Come on.
I was over with the group last night trying to keep Trump out of NBC.
What's going on with the Trump thing where they pulled a promo, speaking of which? Did you hear about this? He was calling Ben Carson a total loser?
I thought you were going somewhere else with that.
Yeah, I know.
Huh?
I have the promo that was cut. It's nothing.
Why are they making a big deal about it?
Probably just to stir up controversy to get people to watch.
Right. I'll watch.
Right. It's 20 seconds. Let's see
DVR.
This. Let's see
Donald
this.
Donald Trump is hosting Saturday Night Live this week with musical guest Sia.
Musical guest?
Because of equal time rules for television, Mr. Trump can only speak for 4 seconds in this promo.
So let me just say this. Ben Carson is a complete and total loser.
That was a cool promo. Why would you?
What's the problem?
Maybe because Ben Carson's ahead of him, it looks stupid now.
What is the problem?
Maybe you're not allowed to say that because you have to get Ben Carson time to respond.
Yeah, maybe it's an equal time thing.
Yeah.
Well, they still put it up online and then they took it down.
At first they said they put up the link to the commercials early by accident. They accidentally...
No, they got in trouble.
I know.
Okay.
They're stirring
maybe
it
they
up.
Did that knowing it'd be a problem.
Right.
And they, just...
They're stirring it up so you suckers
it's
all
got us
watch.
Talking. It worked.
Yes. Sure did.
Sure did. Is right.
Let's go to Nick in New York. Nick, go ahead.
Hey, what's going on, man? Look up the Bud Select logo.
The Bud Select.
Yeah.
Let's look this up.
The crown's a bunch of dicks.
It's a bunch of dicks. I didn't even know. All right, Bud Select. Come on.
Oh, come on. Stop
it. You're ruining our bit.
I'm hungry now. I'm hungry.
That actually.
Where's the penis? Where's the dicks?
Mine actually does look like the one on the left.
Does it? Okay.
Budweiser factory. I know a guy works at a Budweiser factory, and one of the ladies who worked there is trying to sue them for that logo.
I don't see it, dude. I see those big, weird things with crowns on them or something.
Go with the one with the ice. Go up a little. Nah, they're not fucking
dicks. It's a crown. It's supposed to be a crown.
A crown of peni.
Yeah, just crowns all look like cocks if you want to break that down, because they have little things with circles on them.
That's why he's the king.
Exactly.
One more, and then we're going to move on. Kevin, go ahead.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hi.
The Red Dog logo, when you turn it upside down.
It's just, I heard about
this. I see that.
One.
Yes, it looks like a dog on its back.
Oh, it looks like a vagina with teeth.
Oh, wait, what? Where's the eating out part? Oh, there's the eating out part. Okay.
I don't see it.
Oh.
Where?
This is the head, right?
What?
It's like a superhero eating out a girl. That's what I see. Is that what you're trying to say,
not,
Kevin?
That's not what that is.
It's the alien head.
It's the bald-headed guy. But
no, it's not what that is.
I go superhero. That looks more like a mask.
Yeah.
No. It looks like a doggy. It's just on his back.
That literally is not that. That's just a, you know, the shape of a dog's face with jowls.
Upside down.
Yeah, somebody.
Upside down.
That's somebody in the woods when they were 15 drinking. Dude, fucking check this out. And then it's not what that is.
It sort of looks like it. But, I mean,
if you have to turn this stuff upside down, how is it supposed to work subliminally?
Well, your mind sees it.
Well, that goes back to my point.
It won't, though.
It was those guys just fucking with each other. Like, look, I think we can get this past everybody and out there, and we'll know that if you turn it upside down, it looks like she's playing with her clit.
Right.
That's the one we just tweeted out to the people. Yeah, the Little Mermaid with the penis on the cover. That was a big one.
Is that real? I mean, like, is that, you think that was on purpose?
Oh, that was a huge one.
Is it a fish penis?
It's a fish penis. Google fish penis.
Yeah, that was that made the rounds.
Under the
a few
sea.
Years back. We got Elvis Costello coming
under
in today.
See.
What do we tell him about all this shit?
Might as well.
Elvis, check this out.
Just blow his mind.
That cover of that album that he did with Burt Bacharach has a big cock between the two of them.
Yeah, oh, really?
It does. Yeah, if you,
yeah.
And it's Burt's cock. And Elvis has a hold of his balls. And the name of the album is Come In My Face. But it's good.
Very
it's
soothing.
Good.
Very classic.
Yeah. Burt Bacharach could put out an album called No One, except for maybe three people, could sing this. This is shit so difficult to sing.
What has he done that was really hard to sing?
All the 1960s stuff that the lady...
Streisand?
No, it was also the lady that went on to be the, like, have the telephone future thing, whatever her name was. You would call her up and she would tell you your fucking future.
Oh.
Miss...
Dionne
Ramtha?
Warwick?
Yeah. Ramtha?
Warwick.
Yeah, Dionne Warwick.
Dionne Warwick.
Right, yeah. All those songs are, like, impossible to sing. Yeah, that's why she sang just about all of them.
So I guess she was considered a good singer.
She was considered one of the best. Mm. They were like, you're a good one.
I didn't like her for some reason growing up. As a kid. She was like on Solid Gold. Wasn't she on Solid Gold?
She was everywhere. Yeah.
But
was.
What do I remember her from when I was a kid? I just was like, ugh, this lady.
She was a host of something.
Yeah, I want to say Solid Gold, but I could be wrong. My youth was just filled with...
She was on the Rockford Files.
No, as herself.
I love the Rockford
Files. I don't know. I don't
Have you
see
watched
anything.
It again, though?
Yeah.
Because they're rerunning it.
On MeTV, and, I watched
Yeah,
it.
There's like zero plot to any of it. Because I was like, oh, God, Rockford Files is back on. Got to watch it. And then I'm like, what? This is the Rockford Files?
Rockford Files. I think it was maybe her nose that bothered you.
I don't. I don't remember as a kid if it was. It might have been. I just remember hating her when I was growing up.
It's not a Love Boat.
No. This was something she was hosting. Yeah, Solid Gold.
Solid Gold.
Solid Gold.
She sang the theme song.
What was the theme song to Solid Gold?
Solid Gold.
Hey, there's Red Oaks on the page. I wrote on that show.
Ooh.
It's on now. You can download it on Amazon.
What's Red Oaks?
It's called Red Oaks. Paul Reiser's in it. It's a coming of age tale. About New Jersey in the 1985s.
1985s.
Yeah.
That sounds like a good
it's
watch.
It's good. It's funny. It's kind of like Flamingo Kid, Caddyshack-ish.
All right, let's check out Red Oaks.
A good show.
Flamingo Kid is great, man.
Yeah.
He never gets brought up when people bring up the
80s. I haven't seen that in years.
Is
Matt Dillon
and a host of young Jewish kids. So it's just a very funny, like this Jewish beach club. And it's great, man.
It's really
I've
good.
Seen it, but it's like one of those things that you realize, oh, God, I haven't seen that movie in 28 years.
Yeah.
Red Oaks is funny. Rachel Feinstein has a part in it.
I think it's going to be all right for you, Tom.
I think
people are going to check out Red Oaks.
It's a good one.
And we got this now.
What's the theme to Solid Gold?
We got it. Here it is.
Welcome to Solid Gold. Now in stereo.
Ooh. Now it's stereo.
Starring Dionne Warwick.
Her giant fucking teeth.
Johnny Mathis.
He looks like they have the same teeth.
and Solid Gold recording stars, Tina Turner.
Wow.
Miss Dionne Warwick.
See, this is too white for me. It's just, it's too white.
You know you can edge it if you let the song.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, her nose is awful. And so is her. She has the biggest teeth I've ever seen on a person.
She loved that short hair, too.
Yeah. She should be in fucking...
Horrible.
Yes.
This is what a flashback.
This is wow. Amazing how not one dancer has any talent whatsoever.
They were all on coke.
He didn't need that back then.
Yeah. That fucking head belongs in Jack Waltz's bed. That's Whitney Houston's aunt, right? I think she's Whitney Houston's aunt.
Yeah. All right. We
how come she
take
wasn't
a break?
Found in the tub?
Yeah.
Is that, it's a fair question. Is that, yeah.
Fair question.
Just asking
she's
questions.
The princess
I don't know.
Of solid gold.
You know?
Just asking questions.
Damn good question. I thought this was an XL channel.
Tom Papa, where you at? Why are you in town?
I'm going up to Westport, Connecticut to do this little theater.
Nice.
And then next week I'm playing the Keswick Theater in Glenside, Pennsylvania.
Ooh.
And going to Wilmington, Delaware, doing a little thing down there. Ooh. Just doing some stand-up, just going around making the people laugh
making
before
people
Thanksgiving
happy.
Comes.
Yeah.
Which is right around the corner now.
Right around the corner.
Three
it's coming.
3 weeks from today. Ron you Bennington in studio. You promoting anything, Ronnie?
Yes. I am
you got
doing
the floor.
I'm doing a show with Jenny Hutt called Hutt and Putt. It's a ladies' golf. It's a ladies' golf show. As a matter of fact. GPS I'll be doing on Deep Tracks this Saturday.
Really?
Yeah. Where I take Gail and I take a look at 1970s New York City rock.
Wow.
It's pretty cool.
Nice.
Did you ever
check out the Ramones?
You know what? They just may show up in this. I don't want to give anything away, but they may show up.
You're going to have a little Lou Reed in there, I know.
Who knows? I don't want to give anything away.
Jimmy's not a big fan of Lou Reed.
What?
Don't like Lou
not
Reed?
Not a big fan.
Why?
Loathe.
Loathe is this.
I like the song that the song you guys played. I thought it was good.
Oh, Satellite of Love.
Yeah, and take a Wild Side's okay because it's iconic, but just that, you know, and the color girls going doot, do-do-do, do-do. Ugh, fuck you.
That was
what about White Heat? You ever hear that?
I'm sure I did, but I don't know it.
What about Velvet Underground stuff?
Yeah.
It's not surprising. It seems like your kind of thing. It's a little tranny and New York-y and
I'm not saying
New
there's York-y not elements of it that I respect, but just dumb. How do you say that?
Give us a Lou Reed song. We'll play it in a break.
No Lou Reed for me. I don't want to give you know.
Give me one.
What do you need?
Just something different.
How come?
Satellite of Love.
No. What about? Give me a Lou Reed song.
But these songs are...
a little deeper. I don't give a fuck.
Well, they're a little long, too. You know you got great comedians in here today.
Mm-hmm. I know what you're saying. It's going to start off kind of slow and kind of drift in, and Jimmy's going to shit on it all.
No, we'll be eating while it's playing.
Yeah, we won't hear it at all.
Exactly.
We just turn it down. That's for the people
out there. Satellite of Love.
All right, for Velvet Underground, play Sweet Nothing. It's a nice song about heroin that...
Well, I hope it doesn't glorify it. That's important to say.
Oddly, I don't know if any song ever is rough on heroin. You know? I remember being a little kid listening to music going, where do you get this heroin?
Sounds amazing.
The Velvet Underground do a 15-minute song called Heroin.
Yeah.
And at the end of it, you feel like all I want to do is heroin. I just want to fucking do it.
Yeah, I don't think there's one bad song about heroin.
I can't think of one. I can't think of one where to turn that off. Turn off that heroin song.
The banana on the Velvet Underground, is that really a banana?
Well, that's, you know, Andy Warhol, so no. No, it is not.
Yes, it's on a chair.
Yeah.
It's 7 minutes, but we can make up the time another way, right? With our filler? Well, all right, instead of filler, we'll have this song, so we're good.
What's your filler?
It'll be the exact same break.
What's your filler?
It's
happening for 56 minutes.
Mm.
That's radio talk for time to go to the bathroom.
Okay.
All right. More with Ron Bennington and Tom Papa, but first
I'm leaving for Charlotte today.
That's right.
Tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday in Charlotte.
Where? What
zone.
Club?
Comedy Zone.
Ah, it's a good club.
It's awesome.
You're gonna love it.
Charlotte's nice.
Love Charlotte.
Fucking hit home runs there.
You know these? They're undefeated now too. This is their year.
Yeah.
Who?
Panthers.
Carolina Panthers.
Right. They're one of the last undefeated teams.
Cam,
I think we're down to four, right? Something like that.
I like to wear a local jersey on stage. Gets the crowd on my side.
Beautiful.
That is smart.
Hey, Panthers fans in the house. My arms up. They go bananas. Heat out of the palm of my hand.
You know who I hate? The fucking Redskins. Am I right?
Yeah, and sometimes I have to go, who's the rival? Who's the rival? I'll have to ask off y'all.
What's the local strip club?
Some Velvet Underground. We'll be back. It's Ronnie's song. There you go, Ron. For Ron Bennington in studio today.
Thanks. Thanks for that.
I hit the post, too, by the way.
Sweet.
Wow. I really enjoy your show.
No.
I do. When I'm driving around in L.A.,
yeah,
there's something that you come on with when I'm doing the kids thing or whatever. Yeah. It's really a nice program.
You won't enjoy this replay.
You guys are really good.
You know, some. First of all, it's nice of you to say. And as I was actually saying this during the break.
Mm.
Largo, Tom Papa. I don't. Every time I look up, he's doing the coolest shows I've ever seen. I don't know how you're pulling off these shows.
Well, it's about just a passion.
It's your place in the business right now. You know what I mean? This is your time. And it really is.
You just find what you love, and you just kind of do it.
How's L.A.? You miss New York, though, right?
Oh, man. Walking, I miss it so much.
You notice how different people are out there? Go ahead, run with that.
I'll tell you this. You won't miss the weather. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Especially this time of year.
Because it gets cold here.
I tell you, every December I go, there's something to it out there, you know?
Yeah.
It sure is different.
You can't just leave your house and walk around and have everything at your fingertips. That's got to suck out there.
Oh, man. I'm just staying downtown and just walking around. It's just... heart is just crushed when I come back to New York.
And you really took advantage of New York when you lived here, man.
I loved my whole adult life.
You loved it here.
And my kids want friends now, and they want to go to a school where they're the only white people. And they,
they do?
They're tired of swimming in the fountain at Washington Square Park. And
do they miss New York?
A little bit. The older one does a little bit.
Yeah.
The younger one, not so much.
They're over it.
Yeah.
You're not, though. You would move back tomorrow.
Oh, I know. I really would. Yeah. But I try and come at least once a month and hang out with my friends. That's why I'm here, right, fellas? That's why we're all having this moment now.
Absolutely, Tom. We look forward to your visits.
Friendship, right? Friendship.
Absolutely. Friendship. Yeah. Underrated.
Friendship.
It is a good thing, though. I have to say... One of the good things about being out there is I'm in the car a lot.
Yeah.
So I listen to you guys all the time.
Yay!
And it's so nice. Yeah. But then it's the replay, so I can't call in with my little antics.
Your little jokes.
Yeah, I want to call in and be like, hey, I got a comment on that, but you're already on your way to the gym.
You should write down stuff and then just talk about it when you come in.
Could I fax it in? Could I fax jokes?
Just text them.
Do we still have a fax machine? Does that exist?
That's a very good question, Ron. Yeah. That was a big deal in radio for a while there, for a couple of years.
Accountants and lawyers still use fax machines. Like my accountant will go, could you fax it? I'm like, will you shut up? No, I can't. Now you can snap a photo with your cell phone and just send that, and it counts as a signed document, which is so much better.
I used to love when the girls would send their boobs through the fax machine. That was like a real big deal.
Because it would come slowly.
Oh, it's like, we got another one.
You know, I live in a pre-war building, right? It's an older building, and we still have a telegraph. We'll just... the fucking
it's hard to send the boobs.
Yeah, just slap your tits on it. That's the thing.
Do you really live in a pre-war?
Yeah.
How's your like service and cable and all that stuff?
Everything's great.
Oh, it is good. Okay.
Yeah, they figured out the pre-wars.
Yeah.
They figured out. They've updated those buildings.
Yeah, they know what they're doing.
Yeah, you know.
I like a modern building.
Do you like a modern building?
Yeah, modern amenities.
Yeah.
For that,
What do you have in there? Like a water fountain? What do you?
I don't know. It's just everything seems to work a little better. I don't like the thick concrete of older buildings.
Yeah.
Cell reception blows. Giant fucking thick old walls. Like a nice glass.
You can feel it.
It'll help you if a 9/11 happens, though.
It's a good point. I mean, if somebody attacks my building, I do want to be safe.
You could feel the souls in those pre-war buildings of the people that lived there before you.
Ghosts? I mean, you don't get ghosts in those big
buildings. Over 80 people have died in my apartment over the years.
Really?
You can go back and check it. There's even a thing online. 80 people in the 70s 15 people were murdered in my apartment. Isn't that fucking crazy?
That's nuts.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Rick James's house for a while.
Yeah, there was two women were tortured, sexually tortured, mutilated, man, and then left for dead.
And that was in the 2015s.
Yeah, this was 2 weeks ago. Nieces came to stay with me. They wouldn't get, you know, couldn't get them to bed. Yeah. So
showed them The Shining. You know, they didn't catch on.
Yeah.
Are you moving, Jimmy?
Yes.
You found a place?
I did.
Nice. When do you move?
It'll be months. It's not even known. A lot of stuff to still do.
You going to a different part of town, or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm
staying in town, though, yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
Going out to Queens.
It's nice out there. Yeah. Oh, God, it's beautiful.
I want it to be.
You know what? It'd be easier to get to the airport, so that's always
That's
nice.
What I've been saying myself, with the exception of Newark. But that little part of me has to be negative, with the exception of Newark.
Is that your favorite? Newark, so your favorite airport out of the three?
I don't know. JFK kind of grew on me. LaGuardia's decent.
LaGuardia's scary.
No, but the JetBlue terminal. The JetBlue terminal is great.
They
what don't you like about LaGuardia?
They have a short runway, man.
Very short.
You know when you're landing. When you
but how long of a runway do you really want?
They got to do the reverse thrusters.
He knows.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like to get off the plane quickly. I like a nice short runway.
Absolutely.
When you take off, that bay comes quick. You're like, are we going to make it?
They're always skidding into the water.
Holy
over there.
Yeah. Fuck.
It's great.
Always no, that's that was scary, man. And they do that bank turn to line it up, too.
Most delays of any airport in the U.S.
It's a horrible airport.
LaGuardia.
Well, that's also because you're competing with JFK and Newark airspace. They're all coming down the same, as we like to call it, corridor.
Right.
Corridor, yeah.
Okay. Like a hallway.
Yeah, so it's very bumpy and turbulent when you're coming to Newark, because three different airports are using the same
corridor.
Yeah.
But that's why you end up in the water.
Yeah.
I like it because you can end up close to other planes, and a lot of times I'll just be like celebrity, you know, clock.
Yeah.
Like, so who's in that other plane?
I think that's Jack Nicholson.
Oh, man. Yeah, see, the Delta jets skidded off in this area. That's probably where you're at now.
But when?
In the winter.
Yeah, you're right. When?
It was winter.
Yeah, don't fly in the winter.
They skidded.
Yeah.
ISIS took down that plane now, huh?
I don't believe in it. Are they?
ISIS video claiming they bombed the Russian plane.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
I don't think so.
There's something weird about that whole story.
What is that? Is that footage of it falling or no?
Yeah. They were filming it, and then it exploded.
Wait, let's play this.
Yeah, that's not too
wild. Who was?
This video just
CIA. The CIA has filmed it.
There's some goofy music under it.
Yeah, that's always under those videos. Can you make it bigger?
This is scarier than The Exorcist.
Oh, yeah. Holy shit.
Now, did they have a bomb in the
plane? That music is scaring the shit out of me. Am I the only one that's terrified by that music?
It makes me want white sauce. I don't know why. I'm just starving right now. But did they say they had a bomb in the plane?
They said they had a bomb in the plane.
Not shot it out from like
a bomb.
They had a bomb, and then they're like, okay, here we go. Let's film it happening.
Shot down. I don't know if they shot it down.
Is this proof ISIS shot down Russian plane, killing all 224 on board?
Experts are saying the jet did not lodge an SOS call or have any faults that would have crashed it. Mm. And the footage, it's flying, and then it just smokes or whatever, and then it's plummeting straight fucking, like the wings are out to the left and the right, and it's coming straight. Those people are alive on that plane. They're not all dead. Some of them might be.
Right. They were alive until they hit. Yeah, they're filming it because they know what's about to happen.
And they're saying that this is reaction to them going after ISIS in Syria.
Oh my God!
Is that the follow up to Everybody Wang Chung tonight?
That was my graduation song.
Yeah, it's nice.
Wow,
it's a good one. It's a really, really good one. I don't know what it is about the Arabs. They have terrible music. Here I said it. You know what I mean? I put it out there. I do not like their music.
Is that Quran stuff? I think everything. The only thing they're allowed to listen to is like Quran verses.
Oh, is that right?
I think so. That's all the music they listen to is just the Quran being sung.
That and Lou Reed.
I think someone should bring that country a guitar. I think they would love it. I think it would change everything. Maybe a keyboard. Just try
something.
Something.
How's that play? Did that video end there, or does it show more?
That's all they got so far. Okay. It's quick. It's 18 seconds. We'll tweet it
that's
out.
That's terrible footage.
Either that or just run it backwards. Just so, you know what I mean, to see what it would be like. Yeah.
That left out of Egypt?
Yeah.
I believe so.
And they say it's because...
How high was it when it went off? Like, meaning, how do you find a plane in the sky and film it? They said it fell from 30,000 feet, right?
Yeah.
How the fuck are you filming a plane at 30,000? Unless it was just a random plane they shot when they saw it.
But I thought the bomb was on the plane.
That's what I'm saying. If you know, how do you find
a bomb on the plane
at 30,000 feet?
You're saying how do you videotape?
How the fuck? Oh, that's the plane. Let me follow that.
Probably videotaped 20 of them, and then they got the one.
Or maybe they just
they know
faked
the flight
it.
Pattern.
Maybe it's not it at all.
Flight pattern. They're filming all of them until it was the one. Extreme close up. Obviously, that's why the footage is.
Maybe
so
they
have
the iPhone 6S because that's a pretty good camera.
It's pretty strong.
Oh, damn.
You're good things about the S6.
I didn't wait in line for it, and I should have.
You should.
I always regret.
I was going to do it, but I was in line for Star Wars.
God, I can't wait for that. I'm so pumped up for it.
What's that?
Robots. These Star Wars movies, they have robots. And
space, a lot of space.
Yeah, a lot of space stuff. It's so much fun.
I can't wait to learn the new characters' names and languages.
Well, my favorite is Soccer Ball. That's my favorite robot right now is Soccer Ball.
Yeah, he's like the R2-D2 without feet. Yeah.
I just can't get, you know, they're going to start and put three of those out a year. They said by the time they're done, just Star Wars will be just constant in the theaters.
Hopefully, it will drain all the nerds of their money and they'll go away once and for all.
The nerds are the only thing that's left in this country.
It's really true.
It's mainstream culture.
Yeah.
I remember when it used to be like, oh, they're nerds. Don't pick on them.
There is nothing nerdy about these people.
Yeah.
There's true nerds don't get girlfriends, can't talk to you.
Right.
These are not nerds.
They're fake nerddom.
They're fake. Yeah.
They're really good-looking guys, and they pretend like, oh, I'm so awkward and ugly. And meanwhile, they're 5'11 with a chiseled jaw. Fuck yourself.
Exactly.
Fucking fake nerd. Shut up.
Well, who are the true nerds now?
You know,
these people were the nerds when we were growing up,
yeah,
but they're mainstream.
Hip people are the fucking the hipsters, nerds. They're the outsiders.
Yeah.
That's becoming quite mainstream. It's
no, not right. Fucking hipsters. Actual fucking cool people are the fucking outcasts in this country.
If you shake their hand and it's not, you don't come away with wet moisture on your own hand.
Yeah.
That you did not just meet a nerd.
And yeah, if there isn't something fucking physically wrong with your spine, stop saying you're a nerd.
Oh my God.
You're lying about being a nerd.
Yeah.
You just don't want to fucking grow up.
You just looked me in the eye. Yeah. You're not a nerd.
Yeah.
Oh, we all had a few of those in school, didn't we?
The real guys. They were tortured.
Yeah.
Their skin was awful. They couldn't talk. They loved everything about comic book world, like the real stuff.
Yeah.
Not this.
Because school was so boring to them. It was so easy. They had to find something
else.
Well,
they had no friends. And they had...
they didn't study or anything.
Remember the outcast growing up? There was one outcast who, he was the kid, the dirty kid in school. So everybody kind of picked on.
Smelly.
And his brother actually snapped because people just treated these guys terrible and took a hairspray and a fucking lighter and burned somebody who was bothering him. Yeah, he had just had enough. I mean, it was just enough.
Well, the abuse
torture.
At that time.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Fucking, this
intense.
Is in the 80s, too. It's like it was before with all the sensitivity and.
No bullying. No one talked about bullying.
No, they would torture these poor guys. It was fucking terrible.
Now it's guns.
Yeah.
Instead of the hairspray and the lighter.
The nerds rocking the guns.
Rocking the guns, right?
Intense.
Yeah, those are kind of like nerds.
Dude.
The guys who feel like such outcasts and they're picked on and they're so hated and they just snap and start shooting people.
Yeah, you're right. That's the reason.
Why don't they just go into the woods and smoke pot? Why don't you just fucking not give a shit? Hey, guess what? School blows. So, there you go, kid. Don't fucking worry about it.
Yeah, you could leave.
Yeah.
You can leave. At college, no one's making you go to college.
Right.
But these are the good old days.
What happened to Jimmy's mic?
Jimmy, something happened. I can't hear you.
What happened to your mic?
Jimmy?
Did you pull it out?
Jimmy. Hello, Jimmy. Hello, Jimmy.
Oh, no.
Does anyone see Jim?
Ground control to Jim Norton.
Nope.
Oh, Jimmy's out.
Nope.
He's out.
Oh,
he's out.
God. He's out.
Ah, jeez.
It's really bad. I don't know what happened. Did you pull on something?
Yeah, I was just...
There it is. He's at Norton's back.
So you want to hear something really interesting?
Yeah.
I was pulling my mic back, and I said, I don't hear myself at all. So I did a second ago.
What a story.
It's good stuff.
That's good stuff.
That's good stuff.
Well, here's my new favorite story, is that the police all over the country are telling people not to go to Quentin Tarantino movies. Now, I don't know, you know, a lot of times you'll see, like, you know, like when Gilbert lost his gig because fucking people, or what happened with Ant. But this is literally First Amendment, where fucking people who work for the government, the police, are not saying, oh, we don't agree with Tarantino or he's a dick. They're saying don't go see the guy's movie.
It's ridiculous.
They're saying he should not be allowed to say those things.
No, period. They're saying don't go see his movie.
No, I know that, but that's what they're
saying. I will fuck with your money if you say something we don't
like. But that's basically what they're saying.
But what are the cops supposed to say? Like, he's got a point.
No, they could say he's a dick and we don't like him. But to say boycott his movies, or hey guys, don't take undercover jobs, it's like you said something we didn't like, and I get why they don't like it, but you're the police, there's people going to criticize you, it's okay.
And that's what the First Amendment's all about.
Yeah, it's crazy.
You're going to hear some shitty things.
I love Tarantino, how he won't back off, and Harvey Weinstein, guys went to bat for him. And they're like, look, he can say what he wants, he speaks for himself.
He was on MSNBC last night defending himself. It's long, but can we play maybe the first couple seconds here, see where it goes?
Yep. Or at least the good part.
Just
first couple seconds.
Just play the Sam Jackson part where he's saying, say what again, motherfucker?
Yeah. No, I prefer the part about the storage unit. Pulp Fiction.
I carried this watch in my ass.
Pleasure to have you on. Thank you very much. I want to read for you the transcript of that statement. That has gotten so much attention.
Yes.
And just ask you to elaborate. So this is what he said. He said, you know, what am I doing here? I'm doing here because I'm a human being with a conscience, and when I see murder, I cannot stand by, and I have to call the murdered the murdered, and I have to call the murderers the murderers.
Hello.
What do you mean by that?
Well, we were at a rally that was dealing with unarmed people, mostly black and brown, who have been shot and killed or beaten or strangled by the police. And I was obviously referring to the people in those type of situations. I was referring to Eric Gardner. I was referring to Sam DeBose. I was referring to Antonio Guzman Lopez. I was referring to Tamir Rice. That's what I was referring to.
She's referring to specific cases in which a police use of force has taken the life of someone in a way that you feel was murder.
I believe, in those cases in particular that we're talking about, I actually do believe that they were murder. Now, in the case of Walter Scott, who was the man running in the park and was shot in the back, in the case of Sam DeBose, I believe those were murder, and they were deemed murder. And the reason, and the only reason they were deemed murder is because the incidences were caught on video. However, if they had not been caught on video, the murderers would have gotten away with their murder. In the case of Eric Gardner, in the case of Tamir Rice, I believe that those were murders, but they were exonerated.
There's something about that word, obviously, which has set off police unions and many police officers. Why do you think, were you surprised by the, frankly, the vitriol with which they've responded to those comments?
Well, I was surprised. I was under the impression I was an American and that I had First Amendment. And there was no problem with me going to an anti-police brutality protest and speaking my mind. And just because I was at an anti-police brutality protest doesn't mean I'm anti-police.
See, right there, it's like, I love the fact that he won't back off. I love it.
And he said it. It doesn't necessarily mean I'm anti-police. When this clip
but
first...
But even if he did... can't fucking line it up. I mean, how many people have sit around and go, oh, Obama, he's a fucking said he was going to get us out of there and he's a killer and he kills with his drones. That's why you want to live in America, is so that here's the thing. Do you know, this is even worse than most, because a lot of people will think to themselves, I won't go see that movie. I live in a small town. The fucking cops will see me come in and out of it. I don't want to end up. There's people that are like, I know people that are phobic about cops, right? So if they think there's even any fucking trouble, you know, they're afraid of fucking cops. So this is a really, I think the Weinstein Company should fucking sue.
I don't think they're going to boycott Tarantino's movies, though.
They're doing it now. They said it.
I think more people will go to it because it's got a lot of controversy.
I don't think it'll hurt the bottom line.
People who might not have gone to see it originally will go out and just support and go, you know, especially because it's Tarantino.
I have more of a problem when this clip first hit that the mainstream media really portrayed it like he said all cops were murderers.
That's the big thing. I didn't hear the story, you just heard it secondhand through the news or whatever. And it really made it sound like he was saying all cops are murderers, which is...
I was sort of like, what the fuck? Yeah, and then I saw the clip for myself and said, wow, that's not what he was saying at all. And he just said in that clip, it doesn't mean I'm anti-cop. But I'm calling out what he thinks are the bad ones.
Right,
well, it's like I say every morning when I walk in, guys, context is everything. That's the first thing I say, just remind the gang.
I thought that you said Cotex was everything.
No, I'm against those.
See, that's where I got it wrong.
No, I'm like, bleed into your panties. Let us see what a pig you really are.
A lot of people are confused by the First Amendment. They think it's okay as long as it's something that doesn't offend you, but it means you're going to be offended as well. That's okay in America.
Well,
but they're like, it's the First Amendment until you offend me. Then, then we're not dealing with the First Amendment here anymore.
Does it bother you that they're saying it's a boycott because they're a government group? When people say, I boycott the Chick-fil-A because of the gay stance?
I really think, and then that becomes a problem because it's really not First Amendment because the government is involved.
Right.
But this is fucking literally people who work for the government putting out things saying, boycott this movie for what this guy said.
Yeah. Right.
And I honestly wouldn't care if they said Tarantino is a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
Don't listen to him. He doesn't know shit. Yeah. All right. You can say that. But boycott the movie is where it gets fucking scary.
Would you say it's a slippery slope?
I think it's already the slope right there. I think that's as bad as it could get. But I just
hate that term that they all use. It's a slippery slope.
But imagine like if local police start to go, okay, we don't like something that the guy who owns that restaurant said. Mm-hmm. Don't anyone go to that fucking restaurant.
Right.
You know? That's crazy.
It's all Patrick Lynch. Patrick Lynch, that fucking the head of the PBA, I think he's awful. I know it's his job to protect cops. I get that.
Right.
And a lot of times they get, the shit under the stick press-wise. When everything happens, people are always anti-cop. So he's got to step out and kind of stand in front of these guys.
Right.
But he just never comes out and says, my guy's fucked up. He's got to go. Until his back is so far against the wall, he has zero choice but to do it. He's horrendous.
Is there any connection between the police boycotting and my half-filled show in Pennsylvania?
Yes.
Yes, they're also boycotting. Yeah. I was going to say something mean, and I just decided.
Wow. Wow, that was nice of you, Jimmy.
You know what? That means you're growing as a person.
Absolutely. I protested in my own moment of honesty.
I've never seen that before.
It was amazing to watch.
Yeah.
No, and honestly, it just would, to be totally honest, what I was going to say, it wasn't going to be as barbaric as I wanted. I was going to say they're protesting boring things, but it's like, no, because you're not boring. That won't hurt enough.
Robert is confused. He's in Binghamton. Why should Weinstein sue a police union?
Yeah, I don't think they should sue.
Go ahead, Robert. Go ahead.
No, Ronnie said, I thought Ronnie said,
I would sue the fucking government.
Whoa!
Yeah, the United States government. I'm taking them.
Whoa!
I'm taking them. Okay, wait, let's start slow. Starting to build. Yay! You're out of order!
I'm the reluctant one.
Yeah. I think it's fucking... This isn't the job of the United States government to tell people what movies to go to.
What is their job?
It's the unions that represent the employees. It's like any employee union telling you to boycott something. It's not NYPD saying boycott that. It's an employee union. They're paid to... I don't agree with it. I think...
This is me just hearing it now, too. I didn't know this was just the unions saying this.
Patrick Lynch and the unions. Yeah, okay. It's not the actual...
It's not like the union doing it. Yeah.
The lieutenants, but...
sue the unions.
All right. Thank you, sir. Let's go to Joe. He's a cop. Joe in Texas. What's up?
Hey, boys. What's going on?
Hi, Joe.
Hi!
Hi! Hey, now, I was going to tell you guys, as a police officer for 8 years, I'm still seeing every damn... fucking Tarantino film that I can. He's one of the best directors there are out there.
Right.
You know, I've seen everyone in the theater. I don't know if everybody can say that.
No, I can't say that.
I cannot say that.
But I will say it's similar, like, with the Woody Allen thing. Like, you know, he's the dirty boy, but I love his films.
I did too. Right. It's a little different.
You can separate allegations. The two.
Yeah.
What's that?
You could separate the two.
Yeah.
Roman Polanski.
It does make a.
But as a police film. As a police officer, what do you feel about him making those statements?
I don't know. I don't really agree.
No,
with
oh, as a police officer.
Sorry,
the caller.
Actually, we got one. Thank you, Joe. So it doesn't matter. You're going to still see Tarantino you, movies, buddy. But this guy, Jim in New York, a different angle on it. Go ahead, Jim.
How you doing, guys?
Hey, hi, Jim.
He's cop, NYPD.
First time, long time, that whole thing. Right. Listen, I'm a big First Amendment supporter, and that's the only reason why I'm even calling. I'm a retired police officer. I've been retired 8 years, 23 years with the city. And listen, you guys just got to look at it from another point of view. Police officers are citizens as well, and we have First Amendment rights.
Mm-hmm.
And if the police union is the only way to organize 23,000 New York City police officers and additional thousands of retirees and get the message out that we also have the right to express our displeasure.
See, this is the thing that people always fall back on, and it's the repercussions, and it's why you won't see people running to protect Tarantino. Only one person, big celebrity I know of, and that's Jamie Foxx. But that thing of trying to stop how someone makes his living because you don't like what he said about a couple cops, it fucking crosses the line. Opie and I have worked in radio for a long time. We would never fucking protect bad radio people. Most of them stink. We'd be willing to say that. You guys are comedians. Do you protect every comedian out there? Do you act like, no, we're all in this together?
I do, but then I call in bomb threats to the clubs.
It's fucking crazy to act like every cop is a good cop. It is.
Oh, well, no. I'm not even trying to express that opinion. It would be unreasonable. The thing is...
But you're okay with hurting his livelihood, like Ronnie's saying here?
All right, well, here's the point.
I think that's a bad thing to do.
I agree if you look at it purely from that point of view. If you look at it that every human being, forget about a citizen of the United States, but every human being, when they take an action, there are repercussions to be expected from those actions. You cannot expect to even...
This is
the shit they start in radio.
Yeah.
With the advertisers. Where it's like,
they attack your advertisers.
Right. We have a right to, not want to hear this shit on the radio. So we're going to attack your advertisers until they take you off the radio.
Why should there be repercussions, buddy? Well, let me ask you, why should there be repercussions other than you guys just saying what he said stinks? The guy's an asshole. Put on a uniform or shut your fucking mouth because you don't know what you're talking about. Like, I believe the police should respond like that.
We do say that, and actually, most of us actually don't even. We just ordinarily, and I say we as the collective, I'm not even part of it anymore.
Right.
But the thing is that we're really trying to just go about our business and do our job.
That has nothing to do with what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. You can literally say those things. You can say Tarantino doesn't know what he's talking about. He makes crappy movies. Anything you want to say.
That's fine, right?
But it's the...
We have done that. And if the union, and as a bunch of people who are citizens and can share their opinion as well, decide that they want to exert some force...
There you go.
To show the penalty for saying something that you guys,
whatever the group is, not just the police.
Right.
You're saying exert some force.
Like you guys, for instance, just if people don't like your radio show,
don't listen.
Obviously, complete moron. But there's plenty of them, I'm sure, that do not like your show. And maybe since changes have occurred over the past couple of years, maybe some people fell off. They decided to, like you guys have always said, if you don't like it, turn it off.
Absolutely.
Well yeah, that's
the same thing. We don't like what he's saying, so guess what? We're turning him off
it's the opposite. You're telling other people not to go. And this is what fucking, and right away that keeps anyone who wants to still stay in business from having an opinion. People are going to be afraid to say, oh, I'm anti-abortion, because it will go, oh, let's not go to his movies anymore. Right. You know?
I don't think that it's really going to be. I think.
Oh my God, it's been happening for years in this country. Most people are scared to speak out at this point.
Well, look, even this thing with NBC and Trump, they really do attack the advertisers for NBC. You can go out and say Trump sucks or even NBC sucks, but now you're telling people not to fucking advertise on NBC. It changes people from having opinions.
And the advertisers got to show their balls, though, too.
Why should they?
Not cave to these stupid special interest groups.
Why should they? They don't fucking have a thing. All they want to do is sell fucking toothpaste.
They get scared quickly, though.
Yeah, but why wouldn't they?
Well, they should realize that people aren't going to stop buying their product because...
And it's more of a minority.
Yeah,
sorry, Jimmy.
Those things never work.
I don't know. People have gotten fired for, you know, going down one quarter. You know what I mean? These CEOs know that they can't...
Yeah, like when Tiger Woods had his thing, all those advertisers fled.
Everybody fucking bails.
Oh, man, do they scram.
Yeah.
They don't want any controversy, so as soon as it comes up, they don't even check into it.
Right. What's crazy is that this is really a screwed up... a translation of what he said. Like, this really, like, I don't think the police would have any problem with him saying that these specific things had a problem.
By the way, it's twisted
that he said all police are murderers.
Right.
Of course, as a police officer who goes out and puts your ass on the line every day, you would be pissed.
Yeah.
But that's not what he said at all. Right. We're having this make-believe.
Right. But also, there was 300 fucking people there. You know what I mean? Right. Like, it's so fucking crazy how blown out proportion shit gets.
And we're pro-cop in general, but this is a bad road to go down, where you try to hurt someone's livelihood because they're exercising their First Amendment right. That's not good, man. You want people to speak their mind, and even if it's a shitty thing. You do.
Yeah, just say he's a douche and get on with it.
But there's an old expression, I may not agree with what you say, I'll do something.
That's right.
Let me write that down.
I love that.
That's what my grandfather said to me. I'm going to tell my dad
that. I saw
that
on a poster.
You know? Because I'm trying to tell him some good stuff, you know? Make him feel better.
If I may, gentlemen, I just want to put it out there. I don't think that even the PBA or any police union or a group of police officers sitting around think that, honestly, that they're going to take such a huge fight, even by asking the rest of the world to, you know,
it's more a statement.
Come on board. No one's going to take such a big fight out of Quentin Tarantino's, pocketbook, so to speak, that it's going to hurt him. But you know what this does? This is a form of creating this conversation that we're having right now.
It creates fear. Yeah. It makes people self-censor, which is really scary.
And beyond the boycott, as you look in the document, they're also saying that no police officer should work any jobs doing traffic or security for Tarantino.
They're not saying don't do their job, but they are saying off-duty you shouldn't take extra jobs.
That's once again, just so that we're united.
Look at this. It says, the National Association of Police Organizations, at the last line of it, the National Association of Police Organizations staunchly supports the call of NYPD Association and the Los Angeles Police Protective League to boycott Tarantino's films. Furthermore, we ask officers to stop working special assignments or off duty. They are literally trying to affect what he does for a living because they don't like what he said. He didn't call for violence against police officers. He just expressed an opinion about the behavior of certain cops. And you can't call for someone's job to be affected because you didn't like what he said.
Because they're a government organization.
That's like someone coming out being pro-police. In the case of Eric Gardner, and saying, I do not think that was a murder. Mm-hmm. I think that the cop was totally justified and that guy was wrong. And then people coming out and going, boycott his movies because he's pro-cop and anti-Eric Gardner. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing.
But there are people in this world that do take that position against people who are.
Yes, and it's terrible. You're right.
We're not being police. Let's even take the police thing out of it. Let's just talk about the fact that in this world of a 24-hour news cycle, instantaneous communication, recognition, and being able to pipe up through Twitter, Facebook, and all of the social
Snapchat.
Media.
Yeah, we got Instagram.
Yeah.
Well, did he say IG. Vine? Did he say Vine in there?
I think this is the only way to get the conversation out there from the other point of view. Quentin Tarantino, who has the ability to get the attention of the media, puts his face up, and then voices his opinion to have.
Well, what you're doing, you guys are coming off like bullies. You really are.
And you don't understand how this works against you, because then, like someone said in the room, if you're now pro-cop saying this and that, there's another group that will go, well, fuck that guy. Now let's hurt his livelihood. Because how dare he say that?
Well, and they affect our livelihoods all the time. There's a bunch of police officers that are rallying right now over a union-related issue, a collective bargaining issue in New York City, because they decided to give us a 1% raise retroactively. I'm not even going to start that whole thing.
All right.
There are ramifications that exist with monetary concerns for everybody based on opinion and based on information that is put out there.
But you also have to realize how powerful your organization is. You are a government organization that has a lot of might and a lot of physical power. For you, that's very different calling for a boycott and telling us what to do than some other group. You're a unique group. For you to say people can't talk about this is very different than just somebody in the regular economy.
And I feel like the cops are getting a bad rap. You know, a lot of people think the cops are shitty people, and we all know it's a very, very, very small percentage.
I love Officer Klumpke.
Why aren't the police encouraging cops not to take off-duty work for guys like Ahmadinejad when he comes to the U.S. to protect him?
No shit.
Why is it with the police union calling for their officers to boycott certain other foreign leaders? Because a lot of those guys hire private protection, and you know they do. So the police union isn't saying don't protect these guys who are actually funding fucking terrorism overseas.
So this
just seems like a nonsensical stance to take.
Jim, I gotta go. The other guy fucking left.
Thank you for taking the time to hear our side of it. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Jim.
Take care, man.
I really wanted the other caller because this comes up every time this subject. We talk about this subject. Basically, he goes, yeah, he has the right to say all that, but there are consequences. I know. That's why I wanted to go to him, but he hung up.
There shouldn't be consequences.
There shouldn't be consequences. The First Amendment states that you're allowed to say shitty things in this country.
Yeah.
You're
not
going to like everything you hear.
Not really.
I mean, honestly, how come you haven't seen a bunch of other directors or actors or writers?
Scared shitless?
Yeah,
I'm going to answer your question before you finish it.
Yeah,
they're scared shitless because they know what happens.
Right.
So you already got people not speaking their minds.
Right. I mean, the thing is, I was raised Catholic, and we're the one true religion.
Absolutely, the one real God.
I want to get that out there.
Attaboy, Ronnie.
Yeah. The Jews clapping.
We also, you know, care about his mom. That's a big thing for us.
Absolutely.
I know you Protestants don't give a fuck, but yeah.
She's a good woman.
Yeah, great.
The Tarantino.
Single mom.
Absolutely.
Single mom.
Amazing.
Yes.
Whoa. And a woman with high morals.
Yeah. You know, then, you know, married an older dude.
It's all right. She never even took a cock.
What?
Well, she did after the fact.
Up until he came. After that, she was fucking every hole.
Joseph wasn't like Elvis, where he wouldn't put a dick where a baby's head was.
Did Elvis say when he
He said, I can't put my dick, a baby's head was there.
That is fucking hilarious.
Yeah. He was done with her.
However, where the shit falls out, he had no problem.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was a different time.
We talked about that in the first hour. The 70s were a different time. Let's go to Mike in Nebraska. Mike, go ahead.
Hey, guys.
Hi, Mike.
Welcome aboard, Mike.
Hey, welcome
Mike.
To the
Thank
madness.
Thank you very much.
I tried to jump in.
I was actually at that... I spent the morning, Saturday morning, at a training thing in Brooklyn trying to help cops deal with post-traumatic stress, suicide prevention. And, you know, this year there's been 4 cops in New York who've killed themselves who were active duty. I took the subway and got off right in the middle of 42nd Street. And the protests were screaming at the cops, yelling, you're murderers. I mean, at the top of their lungs, as the police. If you take a look at the Sunday New York Post cover, you can see a cop getting flipped off. This was an anti-police protest.
So what? So, you're allowed to be anti-police.
You are, but when you spend 3 hours in a group of people who are screaming at police officers, calling them pieces of crap, insulting them, a cop with a year and a half on who I was talking to said, I haven't been insulted like this in my entire life put together like I have today. So when you put that in that context, that he spent 3 hours
and a group of people calling cops pieces of crap. And then he makes that statement. If he would have been in, say, 3 hours with a bunch of people with hoods in a KKK rally, and he made that same statement after yelling at whatever...
Guess what happens when we have a KKK rally? We send the cops to protect them. That's what's fucking great about our country. When the Nazis want to march, we make sure the cops go there so it's a safe day.
And we make sure we get a good seat to hear the message.
Go ahead. Well, I'm not saying all the KKK guys are wrong. You know what I mean? Some of them, yeah. They're nuts.
Yeah.
But some of the middle of the road guys.
I don't go for property damage.
The people who have been yelled at and insulted for being murderers, the people who are on that group, would they just say, oh, well, he's got a right to do it. That's okay.
He does have a right to do it.
He does. And just because you're making a good point. The people would the Weinsteins have protected him if he had said nigger or if he had insulted black?
Well, I don't know. Watch the movie.
But he gets fat shamed.
Yeah,
you might be right, dude. You might be right. But
Islam comes up.
Islam.
Would Harvey, defend him if he went after Islam?
But who knows? From my perspective,
Paul, Harvey would.
Just because you're right about that.
You're right. Yeah, Harvey absolutely would.
Because you're right about that, and they might not have defended him if it was a Klan rally, and that would have been, doesn't mean that he should be penalized for saying it here, even though you're right about the other thing.
When this person stands in a group of people and yells at my brothers and sisters in blue and insults them, I'm not going to support his movies.
Okay, then
when you call for a boycott, sounds lunacy.
I think that's
that their brothers and sisters are being hurt. Look, I'm not a radio guy like you guys. I'm sorry, I'm stepping on you. Go ahead.
That's right. No, I was just going to say, going back to Ronnie's point, I think it's okay as an individual to do that, of course, but when you're pushing your agenda for a whole group of people, that's where it gets scary.
Well, isn't Quentin pushing his agenda? Like, why?
He's not encouraging people to boycott the police.
Yes, he was screaming the cops with pieces of crap.
He didn't say that. I'm sure he wasn't marching down the street. I'm sure he showed up.
He was standing in a group of thousands of people, hundreds of people, however many were there, insulting police officers to their face. They had a day to go over and say, you're all a bunch of pigs, you're all a bunch of pieces of crap.
Right. Quentin Tarantino did not do that.
He was in the middle of the protest. Yes, he was. He was right there with supporting everybody.
So he was protesting police brutality, as he said. And police brutality, rally was about. It wasn't fuck the cops.
No. It was an anti-police rally. That's the way it was. You want to call it a protest? You can call it. You frame it any way you want to.
Yeah.
It's all in context. You said that before, Jimmy.
Okay, you're right. So what would have been the appropriate way? Like, how would they have protested just those and been kind to the cops?
If he wanted to sit in his Hollywood mansion, make a statement like that, hey, great, everybody has an opinion. But when you come to the streets of New York 4 days after they buried another police officer...
Yeah, the timing wasn't good.
The timing was definitely not good.
Okay, timing, but anyway, if you come to New York and you stand in the middle of people who are screaming at my brothers and sisters that they're garbage and pieces of crap, I'm not going to support you.
Okay,
and
that's fine.
Who sees that... Is every right to say, you know what, this is ridiculous.
Have you ever gotten any of his movies?
Yeah, I love his stuff.
Okay, then there you go. Hurting yourself, sir. His movies are great.
Yeah, I'm going to hurt myself. But, you're right.
Mike, there's a difference, though. That's fine. As the individual, that's what you have decided to do. But I think what we're trying to say here today is the mob mentality scares the hell out of us.
No,
the mob mentality scares the shit out of the police.
Yeah, I feel this way, so we all should not, support this guy or watch his movies. No. Let the individual decide that.
I think you have to be very, very careful when we give you... the power to you and your brothers and sisters. We give you the badges. We give you the guns.
The pepper spray, skating cars.
Right. And then you have to be careful then how you treat your opinion and your mass displeasure and start to say this.
Opinion that this guy insulted my brothers.
Yeah, you can.
Yes, you can say it. But I'm saying when you publicly now take that, you're going to look what you're coming off as here.
The unions represent groups of police officers who are saying, hey, guys, our people are being hurt. This is a union. This is why they speak for the group, not individuals.
But you're the same folks that complain about the fucking social justice warriors or whatever you call them. And this is really the right wing doing the same thing that the left wing that they always bitch about the left wing about.
It comes
across as fucking thuggish. It really does.
When you go,
when you go for 30,000 feet, everything looks small. But when you're out there, and the individual cop has been insulted and screamed at, and
yes, we understand.
Filed.
Fucking get over it, dude. You know what I mean? It's a protest.
But then I am getting over it. It's a protest.
Yeah.
Quentin Tarantino got himself in the middle of that protest and allowed that to happen, and participated actively in that, and then made that statement.
And
cops who have a feeling that hey, we're going to support the brothers in New York. Because this is what happened? Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, it's party. But I'm getting a text from a cop, a woman I know who's a police officer, and she's livid. She's saying that Patrick Lynch is not different than the police administration he claims to protect his people from. They suspend cops for being outspoken or black sheep, and Lynch wants to hit people in the wallet. It is your job to hear that shit. This is another cop texting me saying that that's part of the job.
Right.
I'm not saying I know what that's like to be a cop, because I don't. But this is just coming from someone who does.
And has Tarantino did this type of thing before? Is he outspoken?
Jimmy, is that really a cop? Is that really a cop or just someone that comes to your apartment with handcuffs?
Either way, she's in charge. Either way, she's got the power.
And is it a legitimate penis? She? Good question. Yeah. Is it she with air quotes?
But kind of I think this is why a lot of people are afraid to be political about anything. You know what I mean?
Of course.
They're terrified.
Political crosses the line when you show up and you scream at cops.
All right, again, you got screamed at. You're fucking driving me nuts with that. Jesus Christ.
Okay, look, you know what? You're a professional on that.
No, he's saying you're driving him nuts because you're saying screamed at, not because you're...
You're saying the same thing over and over.
Right. All right, Mike.
You know what?
Let me move on here.
All right, thank you for calling, Mike.
Thanks, Mike, in Nebraska.
Yeah, you bet.
All right.
What's he doing in Nebraska and fucking Brooklyn at the same time?
I don't know.
I'd like to get to the bottom of that.
John in New York, retired detective. Problem with Tarantino is the type of protest he was at.
Yeah, look, you know, you don't like to see, you know, the police, as you know, they provide this little bubble that you can kind of live in. You don't have to deal with anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's an amazingly hard, difficult, horrible job. So anytime... And I really was walking around thinking he was saying every cop is a murderer. And it's like, well, I don't like to hear that. You know, I don't want to hear that either. But it's not even what he said. It's literally not what he said.
A lot of people say shit that you don't want to hear. So what? You know what I mean? So what? Why fucking make sure that the people who want to see their fucking movie, you know, shouldn't go? That's the fucking part that gets me. Call him a dick all day long if you want
to. Yeah, come out. I would respect Patrick Lynch if they literally just used the shitty language.
Right.
And said Tarantino is a twat and he has no idea what he's talking about. And either do the job or shut your fucking mouth. Like that I would respect.
His film's a derivative. He could have fucking came up with that. Did anyone see City on Fire? That's what they should have came back with.
Yeah. Let's go to CJ. Long Island. Go ahead, CJ.
You guys are realizing that the First Amendment only protects you from punishment from the government.
We know that. The intent of the First Amendment is so you can speak comfortably. Back then, they didn't protest jobs.
Just for the record, I think they probably should have just shut up and not gone seeing the movie personally and everything. But if I go online and I say, like, fuck the blacks, let's hang them from the trees, I should expect, like, that I'm going to lose some business, you know? Like, maybe people...
Yeah, don't say anything at any time. That's the best thing about it. Never say anything.
Well, you shouldn't be afraid to say something, but you should know there are a couple of...
Oh, that's the world we live in, and we all know now there's consequences.
But the problem is, even though you're right to say that, there shouldn't be consequences.
Right, of course. But that's where we're at now.
There's consequences for everything.
We all know it. So, like we said earlier, no one is speaking their mind anymore. No one has a real opinion. They're scared shitless that they're going to lose their livelihood, their jobs, and whatnot.
There shouldn't be to an extent, though. Depending on what you say, people should not support you as much.
Think Tarantino's really surprised that there's a shitstorm about this?
Yeah, he's probably surprised by the level of it, yeah. But I'm thinking about this whole thing, you shouldn't get fired from your job and stuff, and I always hate that. But then I'm thinking to myself one time, like, okay, what if you're a surgeon and you're online, like this guy just said, you're on Facebook and you're like, you know, I don't care what anybody says, I think that the Jews lied about the or all this anti-Semitic stuff or anti-black stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, obviously you're still a great surgeon, but if the hospital's going to go, well, we can't have you, right? So what's the right thing to do?
I honestly don't know.
Like, how do you deal with it? I mean, I'm literally asking. I don't have a proper answer.
I think that the only way that you fight let's say, ignorance is to bring it into the light a little bit. And you're much better off hearing people express themselves, right?
Yes.
Than not. Because then you can at least say, well, look, dude.
That guy's an asshole. Yeah.
Or here's where you're wrong. Look, I want to show you some information. You sit and you discuss it. But the second that you start saying, let's take away job, you shut down discussion completely.
I agree. But should the company, and this, say not a surgeon, say it's the head salesman for a company.
Right.
And he's drawing this anti-Semitic rant on Facebook about the Holocaust. Mm. The company will look at that and go, this guy doing this is going to make our Jewish customers not want to deal with him and us. So then what's the right move?
Yeah.
If you're a private business, I mean, that happens all the time. Right?
I hate it there, too, so I don't know what the answer is.
Right.
See, the thing about that is, if you look at it, a lot of times, most of the people who complain aren't even using that thing. You know, if somebody, and this has happened in the past, of course, with ONA, the people who were most offended were not listeners. And what would they do? Not only talk to the company, but talk to the advertisers. Now, a fucking advertiser they're not even thinking about shit. Normally, they look around at a number. Here's a number. Yeah. Oh, do you reach this number? Then we'll pay it for you. So if suddenly they get 50 calls, if they get 50 calls saying, pull that fucking show, they'll probably do it. Doesn't take a lot.
No.
Does not take a lot to scare people.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah.
Obviously.
And now when you got police officers, who I said we've given this power to, and there are plenty of people that are phobic. There's plenty of people that are afraid of police officers. And they would hear, don't go to this movie. And they're like, I don't want to get in trouble by going to that movie. I don't want the police mad at me. I won't go.
Right. Let's go back to the Tarantino clip, because he was trying to explain himself on MSNBC. Just a little more before we move on to something else.
Sure, hold on.
Just go backwards slightly, just so we know where... Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. ...reality protest, and speaking my mind. And just because I was at an anti-police brutality protest doesn't mean I'm anti-police. And basically, they're... You know, there was a lot of people at that rally, and we were all crying for a lot of things, but there was one thing in particular, which was stop shooting unarmed people. We want justice, but stop shooting unarmed people. But they don't want to deal with that. They would rather start arguments with celebrities than examine the concerns put before them by a citizenry that has lost trust in them.
So, when I first saw the news of this, my first thought was, wow, what was Quentin Tarantino doing at this march in New York City? How did you come to be at that event?
Well, the organization who put it on was it's called Rise Up October. And they got in touch with me because I had made statements in some interviews, you know, along the way that had suggested that I'm on their side when it comes to this issue of, you know, ultimately what I feel is a problem of white supremacy in this country. And they realized that I was, you know, they gathered that I was on their side, and they approached me about it, and they explained the situation to me, and I was happy to show up. And the reason I was happy to show up, and what we were doing there, was it was a 3-day rally. I took part in 2 days of it, and the main thing that we were trying to do there was stop. There's a lot of statistics going around about how many people have unarmed people have been killed by the police, but we want them to stop being numbers. We want them to stop being statistics and start being people who were once living and breathing and are now dead. And the idea was to go there and to say their names and to show their pictures and to send the families over to New York and tell their stories about what happened. Really, for us to bear witness to those stories. And the other day of the rally, which was the march, was to demand justice and demand that the police stop shooting unarmed people.
Do you think...
I mean, that's not an unreasonable thing to want. Now, there are guys that are unarmed that are a fucking problem and are a threat, and I'm glad when the cops shoot them.
Sure.
Unarmed people who are shot are not people that shouldn't have been shot.
Course.
Some of them
of
should
course.
Have been shot. But, you know... I guess each case is different. Spoken by a man who didn't graduate high school and isn't a cop. All
right, but you are unarmed, so you're coming from that point.
That is true. And argumentative, I've been told.
It goes on and on from that point.
Yeah, we can all just make love.
Yeah.
Why don't we take a break? Ooh. That's some heavy, heavy stuff.
So right heavy. Heavy.
Yeah, got heavy quick, didn't it?
Really,
yeah. It really got away from us awful fast. but
the
yeah.
Find a Donald Trump
on SNL.
Yeah, let's find Donald Trump.
Oh, that's going to be really racy.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's find a Donald Trump clip and get back to the fun.
I wonder if SNL will do something with Quentin on their show. They're always topical. They always take something and put it out there.
My favorite part of that is like when you feel like you're watching a sketch and it just stops and they're live from New York. And I'm like, I forgot.
I never saw that part.
It's always at the end, the first sketch.
Oh, the first sketch.
But my idea, and I said,
and what did they say? I'm sorry.
They yell live from New York and starting out. But I said to Lauren, do that to end every sketch. You know, all night long.
Where did you tell Lauren that?
I was talking to down the hall. But I would even think that every band should end yelling that out, too, at the end of the song.
Live from New York.
Yeah.
This way you never feel like you're missing some of the show.
Right.
You always feel like you're tuning in the beginning.
You're involved.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
I think Dionne Warwick tried to do that at Solid Gold, but it didn't stick.
Yeah, giant teeth
got in the way. By the way, Dionne Warwick, anti-cop, 100%.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. That's not her real nose. She's just angry that her nostrils are flared.
I just want to come up with people that I think are anti-cop. Put the word out so we don't go and see any of their stuff.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Support them. Yeah.
The guy that directed Mission to Launch.
Really? That guy?
Yeah.
Damn. I think so.
Which is a great movie. but see, here's another thing with cops, and I'll just get this out of the way. It's just my thing. If undercover cops would wear a uniform, I never would have sold them anything. So that's the only reason why I got in trouble. I didn't think it was a cop. Guy had long hair.
Yeah, that's sneaky.
Yeah.
Yeah, busted.
Yeah, in the bathroom of the Spectrum.
Oh, God.
The old Spectrum.
Really?
Yeah. But it was only selling, you know, PCP. But when I
got arrested on the way back from the Spectrum.
Really?
Yeah, just for having a little weed.
Yeah, you had a different incident with an officer in the bathroom at the Spectrum. The fucking Larry Craig moment. Did you ever see Come to Papa? Because you're drilling a hole. How much time did you do?
Spectrum?
No time. I was a kid. You know what I mean? I was under 18. I was at an Aerosmith show. And but even when they were saying back at the thing, they said, how stupid are you selling fucking dope to an undercover cop? This is the fucking detectives.
It's funny that you were selling it at a concert.
Yeah.
Like, you're not just smoking or getting some.
No.
You're actually dealing as a barrister.
I had a part-time job. An after-school job is the way I saw it, and during school. But I've got the guy's wearing a Flyers fucking jersey. If he's wearing a uniform, I'm not selling the fucking dope to him. I'm moving along.
That was
probably
mean.
Not even making eye contact.
So how do you answer that question? I need to know. He goes, he asked you how stupid are you that you're...
I just told you. I literally said to him he wasn't dressed.
He wasn't dressed.
In a uniform. That's
classic.
I would be fucking crazy to walk up to a cop car and ask him if he wants to buy drugs.
Yeah, that's why people do things to undercover. That's why they're undercover, because you won't know they're police.
See, that's cheating. That's cheating.
Now I get it.
Like, he should, if you sold to a uniformed officer, he would say, how stupid are you to sell to a guy with a badge on? And he would have been right.
I wonder if the other cops say, I work as an overcover cop now. I'm just riding around in the uniform.
Breaking news.
What's that?
What?
Your favorite person's on Periscope.
In bumper-to-bumper traffic, there's nothing.
Listen when she's listening to Kansas.
Yeah.
It's fine.
I didn't take her for a Kansas fan. I'm
only reading when I'm standing still.
Hey! She's crying.
I gotta do something for my head. I don't know what I'll do when I get to work.
I'd like to suggest a shotgun.
She loves Periscope.
Yeah, she's out there.
She's
getting hearts. She's getting a couple hearts.
She loves it. Yeah. They're suggesting she takes Excedrin.
That's a good idea.
For the headache.
That's a good idea.
Oh, no. She's probably menopausal. That's the worst.
Navigation. She's just tell me where to go. How's
hot
that?
Flashes.
Yeah.
She's not even driving, right? She's got a driver.
Well, she's parked.
I think she's in the front.
My head hurts. I'm on my way to the city to interview Regina King, which is great because I really like her. So I'm happy to be doing that.
And then I have to...
Just in case.
Go get my hair colored.
Oh, my God.
Oh, God.
That's why I love her.
In case your wife doesn't annoy you enough, tune in.
That's why I love her. Oh, God. Jenny Hutt. Killing it on the Periscope this morning.
Yeah, she's doing it.
She's doing it, all right. Yeah. We got Tom Papa in studio. Tom's going to be doing some gigs. I forgot your gigs. I should do it.
I'll be in Glenside, here. Pennsylvania next Friday, and right. Wilmington, Delaware. Go to TomPapa.com for our tickets for all things Tom Papa.
All Tom Papa. Jimmy's going to North Carolina after the show.
Where are you going down there?
I'm going to the Comedy Zone.
Oh, that's a good club.
Really good.
I love it. Yes. Charlotte?
Yeah.
You should wear the jersey of their football team.
Well, the Panthers are undefeated right now.
I have not heard.
Yeah, that's a great thing. Yeah.
You should wear the jersey out.
Yeah. Go out dressed as a cat. And just
I'm here to support.
Yeah. I love football. You know, and just your opening bit, you're just playing with yarn for 15 minutes.
I love you, Panthers.
And Ron Bennington's got a show at noon on Raw Dog.
Oh, I can't wait for that.
Got to be special today.
Yeah, it's going to be very, very special today.
Good.
Did he just fart in the middle of his promo?
He knows that he cannot leave it in, right?
Absolutely not.
It's bad for him.
It's unhealthy.
It's not.
That's called an exclamation point. Honest promo.
So, boom. And then you're doing something for the Deep Tracks channel.
GPS on Friday.
At what time Friday?
3:00.
All right, now I'm going to listen to Deep Tracks.
Good. Oh, there's so many things to listen to.
Yeah, there's so much.
Good morning.
Oh, boy, she's
this
back.
And yeah, then I'm going to do a podcast with Jenny Hutt about things that bother.
Now they're discussing that a leave is better than the Excedrin for her headache. So.
See, I'm on the other side there. I'm on the other side of that one. I got news for you. I like to crush them up and snort them. I just feel like it gets, you know, it hits the pain faster, you know?
It's not going to happen. Okay, that's cool. I like them.
What is she yammering about?
I don't know, but since I don't watch Walking Dead, this is fun for me.
She's talking about us.
Well, I need my car because I spoke to Gail Bennington this morning.
Oh my God, yeah, she wants her to do the show.
Yeah, I'm not a meth user, so.
I'm not a meth user?
I just got vitamins, though.
She's answering the questions like they're real. Are you gay?
I don't smoke pot or.
You are very, very pretty. Wow. Oh, wow.
No, don't call Opie. That's okay. It's good enough.
Anyway.
All right, why are we watching? This is horrendous.
This is so why we watch.
Right, someone just told her to ride their pole.
You guys don't seem to understand what
it's
like.
Voss's right there. That's Voss's picture right there.
Exactly, Voss right here.
Voss from home.
Ride my pole.
Opie has bigger boobs than you.
I just want to get there soon.
Use the thumbprint hand.
Okay.
God damn it, slow down. Sunglasses, you need them if you have a head. Oh, God.
E-Rock
is a dinosaur. Do you like Putin? You need a passenger for the HIV lane?
I don't know.
C-cup Opie. By the top of your breast, you're in good shape.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Where are you going? Take mass transit? Why am I reading these? She's not a MILF.
All kidding aside, you're a MILF.
She's not a MILF.
All kidding aside, you're a MILF.
They're not. Not a MILF.
Mother, I'd like to stop listening to.
I smell farts.
That was me that wrote that in.
Here's the wheel.
Next to Jimmy.
SNL should do a sketch about her. Like, you put her in a car and you have the things come up. You could write your own comments and you could just, you know, plan it out your own way.
See, you know how these things work.
Well, I'm in sketch comedy and stuff. You know, it's just a passion of mine.
Right. It's an invasion of privacy.
I don't write, but I'm good in the room. So if you never need me there, you know what I mean? I'm just coming up with little lines. But I don't type, so I'll never finish the sketch.
I understand.
Yeah.
She also clarified that she doesn't fall asleep and periscope it, Ronnie. Like you brought up earlier.
She's really taking everything serious.
Yes.
It looks like the traffic's moving pretty quickly behind her.
Yeah. I saw her do what she called a dump scope, and I'm not even saying what it was. I'm not even saying. But it was good.
All right, we'll get out. Jim Norton will be at the Comedy Zone in Charlotte, North Carolina tonight.
That's great.
A little plug on the Periscope.
Thank you, E-Rock Radio.
Oh, that was E-Rock. Oh, Jesus.
Chip has a big dick. Fuck yeah!
Wow. Anyway, I hope you guys have a better morning.
You're just in traffic. Relax. You got daddy's money. You'll be fine.
And
I can't block anybody because I'm driving, so I'm just pretty much driving. That's what I'm doing. So I'm not touching.
God almighty, babbler.
What a bore. Let me call home to hear this bullshit.
Hold on. I'm starting to get into it a little bit.
Oh, are you?
Yeah, I'm liking it. I want to just see if she gets here. Yeah.
Is she going to make it?
How does this end?
It is. Well, the answer is I'm a natural redhead.
Oh, but she's
boy.
Oh, yeah. No.
Carpet matches a drape.
Great.
Put them on. Hold on.
Let me jizz on those Jewy tits. Come on, guys.
Yeah.
Come on, fellas.
Exactly. I just don't want your mother coming over on Sunday. That's our day. And now she's coming over. And it's going to be just awful. And who's going to watch the kids? I'm not going to watch the kids. You're going to see you watch football all day?
That's me. Crap. Oh, God. Okay. I can't listen to that.
What?
I don't want.
Hey, what's up? Someone's saying hello to me.
Is she talking
garbage?
I don't
want to
listen.
Jenny's a piece of garbage.
No, she's saying don't listen to Opie Radio.
Yeah, show your cuda.
She's starting a boycott.
She's boycotting.
She's boycotting.
Yeah.
She's boycotting the show.
She's part of a union.
I barely any makeup. It's all good.
Oh, those eyes.
Right.
There's no makeup on those eyes at all.
Yeah.
What did she just say about the police?
I did get round up because they're obnoxious.
Your fingers in your cunt. Should we play her song, guys?
Those eyes are four-side white. It's fucking scary. It's scary.
Yeah, she did something with the police. You're right. We should play that.
You want to hear her police song?
Oh, yeah. I'd love to hear it. Protest. I never had the chance.
Tom, do you know this?
No.
You don't know this story?
No.
It's the greatest Jenny Hutt story out there.
What is it?
She has a lot of good ones. Basically, it was Samuel Jackson was starting a whole like ice bucket challenge, but it was a song that he sung to the racist police, and he thought that other celebrities would sing the song and nominate, kind of like the ice bucket challenge. Jenny Hutt was the only other person to ever do this. And then she nominated a good friend of yours, by the way. You haven't heard this.
No.
All right, let's just play it for Tom Palmer.
Oh, thank you.
I can hear my neighbor crying. I can't breathe. Now I'm in the struggle, and I can't leave. Calling out the violence of the racist police. We ain't gonna stop till people are free. We ain't gonna stop.
All you need to know about Jenny Hutt. Are free.
Why would she sing that?
Chris Rock.
I nominate Chris Rock.
She nominates Chris Rock. Like, Chris Rock's going to...
I'm on board.
All right, thanks, Jenny. Yeah, I'll take it from here.
Wow.
I'll take it from here.
How could I resist?
It's going to be Samuel Jackson, Jenny Hutt, and then Chris Rock. Okay.
Someone told you they're playing this song. Do you nominate Chris Rock?
I could watch her Periscope all day, but we got to take a break.
Yeah, I got to take a break.
And then we got Elvis Costello on his way up, so yes. Quick break. Elvis Costello in studio next. Stay there. I get it. Coming back with a little Elvis Costello. We're going to have him in here in a minute or two. E-Rock's pressuring me to promote the podcast because we haven't done that in a while. Latest podcast is Jim Brewer on the show. It's available on iTunes. Subscribe and comment to the Opie Radio podcast. All right. Is that good?
That's good.
We got Roland's food court today later at 8 o'clock tonight. You listen to Roland talk about food with his foodie friends.
Ooh, Roland.
And then good old Sam Roberts at 9 o'clock tonight. Where's Elvis? I heard he was here.
Any minute, we were told.
Now it's any minute. Oh, boy. We're on Roland time
again. He's on 48th Street. Coming in toot sweet.
Oh, it's so funny to be... What you just been singing out with them? So long, girl. I wish this was my book. I wish I wrote this book.
You could just say you did.
I might with my mom, but, you know, I don't want to write a book, but I want to have written a book.
Have a book written. Yes, I understand that.
Well, you've got two big books, right?
Well, there's just a couple of books.
New York Times
best-selling author.
Very well.
I'd like a third one.
I was a New York Post best-selling author. Nobody really cared about that, you know?
I penned an article.
No one ever really brags about that. Well, I got my review in the New York Post.
They printed my letter.
They were taken with it.
I want to read from Elvis Costello's book.
Oh.
Go ahead.
It is a perfect introduction to my life in show business. Almost everything since has been a similar trick of the light. The end.
Wow.
Wow. Now I don't have to read the whole thing.
I tend to go to a page and just start asking questions about it. Like, I'll go, it says here on 311, despite a couple hits and singles, I was still flat broke. We'd done five straight tours, 77. You want to talk about that? Go.
Oh, I don't like to talk about that.
We met. Ooh. Do you remember me? Right. We met at the Paul McCartney. We took this photo together.
With the vegetarian thing.
Do you remember I said, hey, it's nice to meet you, and you said you too?
Right.
So you got a photograph from the sign.
Yeah.
I'll sign it too.
I do.
Because I was there that night too.
You were there that
night. What night was it?
McCartney.
McCartney's
and then he was
concert.
Also at Springsteen.
Oh, maybe it was Springsteen. One of the two.
Yeah,
maybe that's where it was. God, thank God, I almost got foot and mouth.
Yeah, just say this. I saw you were there with Steve Earle. Because that's who he's there with.
He's the best
fan of The Wire. Steve Earle was in that.
Yeah. So boom, easy place to go now.
There you go.
You know? That Wire was something with your friend Steve Earle in it.
Yeah. Did you ever see it? And a bunch of the other you know watched, according to your Ray Charles quote.
Yes.
What was the Ray Charles
quote? Oh, boy. Called him a giant ass nigger or something. It was one of that. It was in an argument. He was drunk trying to end an argument about something. This is in the 70s.
Right.
And the guy, somebody went to the press with it, and I guess he sobered up and apologized.
But why did Stephen Stills and his band get involved in this?
I don't know.
It was a fight between Elvis Costello and his band and Stephen Stills. Stills band and Elvis Costello was saying derogatory things about U.S. Musicians, and that's when he said the N-word, and then there was a big fight.
Did Stephen Stills punch Elvis Costello?
No,
I don't think.
I don't think so.
Personally.
I don't think that could ever happen.
Where's
you could?
He's coming.
What's that? He's in the bathroom. Oh no, he's stiff-legging one out,
boys.
He has those Rock and Roll Hall of Fame legs stiffly out in front of him.
My aim is true.
My aim is.
Hurry up. Hope you wash your hands, EC.
This is a tough spot in radio, right? When you know he's coming, you don't want to start something new because you're not going to have time to go into it.
Exactly.
And then you get into all those bits, and then Elvis comes in.
I just bring him right into it. That's what I do. We rope him right into the discussion.
Right.
Oh, but, you know, I want to get into something, too, about a time that I saw a woman kill herself. I don't know whether we have enough time here, but it was a really, really good story.
Where were you?
Well, I was in the basement of the Spectrum. It was down in the bathroom. I don't know if we have enough time here. I'll jump to the end. She cut both her tits off. I don't know how much time we have, though.
I had no idea she was a cop.
Yeah, that's not even
like,
a true story.
Elvis, give me a second. Give me a fucking second. I'm telling a story.
I know, E-Rock keeps walking. I want to see Elvis Costello. I'm getting Lou Costello.
He's fat.
There's a nice picture with him with Paul McCartney.
They're both vegetarians.
Well,
they both don't eat meat.
Wrote together.
Yes, they did.
Yeah, so you guys collaborated. What was that? Tell us about that.
It was good, but we didn't eat any meat because we're vegetarians.
Okay.
We don't do that kind of thing.
Okay. There he is.
Elvis Costello. Nice to see you.
How goes it?
Good morning, Elvis.
Good to see you, my friend.
How are you?
How are you, buddy? How's your morning going?
Good, thank you.
Very nice. Welcome to the show.
Always looks sharp.
Yes.
Always
got to keep
sharp.
Up standards, you know.
A man in a hat. Everybody likes a man in a hat.
That's it.
Yeah. You know, New York Times bestseller. This is your first book, though, right?
It is.
But it's the whole life story.
That's right.
You could have taken this piece by piece, got five or six books out of it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could have done
The
Hobbit.
That's probably what I should have done. If I'd been in that kind of business, that's what the kind
of
business.
Did you not use an editor? Because you said you wrote the whole thing, your entire thing yourself. Did you just kind of make all that
editor? You know, my editor was called Brandt Rumble. Isn't that a great name?
Yeah, it's awesome. A cowboy name.
I think he was on. No, I think he was like the third hood in the Wild One with Marlon Brando.
Yeah,
he was great. You know, there were lots of things that I took out. You want the other 100,000 words? I'd already written like 60,000 words of liner notes. About sort of 15 years ago. So I'd already told the story of how we did it in the order that we did it. So I didn't start page one, I was born.
Right.
Because that's what it says on Wikipedia. Do you, if you want Wikipedia with a better vocabulary, that's what you get. You know,
all that stuff.
I decided to tell the story from my heart and, you know, the things I cared about.
You're being praised for your honesty in this book, sir. A lot of memoirs, they hold back a little bit. But.
I left, you know, I like Hollywood movies where it goes to black in certain scenes, and you can imagine it, or the train goes into the tunnel. We all know what they're saying, you know.
Yeah.
There's a lot of that kind of scene setting or scene closing in this book, just the same as anything. I didn't go over every little squabble that I ever had or every cruel word, but I was trying to point the way to the way the songs came about.
Right.
The way one kind of music was in my life when I was maybe just a child, and then maybe I didn't understand what it really meant. You know, when you're 8 years old and you hear When Your Lover Is Gone by Frank Sinatra, you have no way of knowing what that song's about. You get to 25, you have a pretty good idea.
Yeah. Well, you loved music from when you were a little kid, and even now songs will still grab you. Other people's songs, I mean.
They do?
Yeah.
Of course.
I don't think there's anything in life, maybe, you know, that can take you back to a place of hearing, you know, certain songs, you know? It's a magical thing about music.
Yeah, the thing is whether you want to live in the past.
Yeah.
Or whether you're happy to visit those places as a tender or a memory that educates you in some way as to something that you maybe could have done differently and you might choose to do differently in the future.
Yeah.
I'm not nostalgic, so even though I was able to look back into it, I don't want to go back.
Yeah.
I don't want to be 22 again. I don't want to be 9 again.
Do you listen to new music?
Of course I do.
Yeah. Oh, I'll tell you, yes, you know.
If you want to know anything, he knows. Yeah.
I would see you in the mornings a lot because we live in the same neighborhood, and I would see you walking with your earbuds in, and I would always think,
"What is he, what is he listening to?
I'm just listening to my own yeah.
Do you listen to yourself if you're on the radio? No. Will you keep it on, or will you immediately turn it off?
No. In the book I wrote, when I made a little tape in my bedroom of my first kind of acoustic guitar song, I think only one of the songs that ended up on my first record was even on it. They were quiet kind of songs. So the local radio station in London, they would sometimes play tapes that people sent in, and I heard they were going to play it. And I was so apprehensive about it that when it came time and I knew that was the hour that we were going to play it, and I went in the kitchen, turned on the radio, and then turned off all the lights so nobody could see me listening to that's how strange it felt. You know?
Yeah,
that's another.
And then a few, you know, a couple of years later. Then the records are coming on the radio. You know, another sort of little image that I remembered was driving in a station wagon down the 405 in California on our way maybe to San Diego, and there's a group of absolutely beautiful, idyllic Californian girls with their hair streaming in the sun and the wind, and our record came on the radio in our vehicle. And we're leaning out the window going, "It's us! Oh, look, it's us!" And they looked up with horror. They were kidnappers. And it was, you know, in England, there was only one radio station, so we thought they were listening to our song. Yeah. They could have been listening to the Bee Gees.
Yeah, right. I've actually done that with other people's music. I just yell out and claim that it's me, hoping to get blown on the highway.
That's always a possibility. Yeah.
Hey, Elvis, did you go into music because your dad was in music?
No, I tried to stay out of it because my dad was in music, to be really truthful. You know, when I was 13 and you're self-righteous, I went, I won't do it. I love it, but I'm not going to do it. But I saw my dad do it. You know, he was in a radio dance band.
Right.
I mean, in a nutshell, my friends had their parents banging on the bedroom door saying, "Turn that music down." My dad was in the front room turning the same songs up so he could sing along with them, because he had to learn them every week to sing them on the radio.
Wow. You explain he would sing at the top of his lungs.
Yeah, he had to, because he had to learn, you know, where his voice worked in the songs.
Sure.
And it's a little different. In America, we all imagined, anyway, that, you know, our images of America, depending on your age, were all filtered through Elvis Presley movies, you know, or, you know, and then later American Graffiti or Happy Days. Wherever you started, it was always seemed like rock and roll was in the background. In England, people used to have to put on dinner jackets to read the news on the radio.
Yes.
So that's what I grew up with. We got the music filtered through all kinds of weird lineups, you know, people playing the hits of the day on the cinema organ. So my dad was just one of the people in that filter.
So if you were avoiding it first, then what happened? When did you get bit by the bug to do this?
Well, first of all, I picked up the guitar when I was about 13 and loved playing it. And I picked up the guitar because I heard a song by Fleetwood Mac, and I don't mean the Stevie Nicks Fleetwood Mac.
The old Peter Green.
Mac, led by Peter Green.
Right, sure.
And one of his songs inspired me to learn to play the guitar. And it was a complicated song, you know, and 12 chords in it. And I worked and worked until I knew all. And then I realized all these other songs were actually easy. And I could play half the songs I loved.
Yep.
And I wrote songs right away, but I still didn't think I would want to get paid to do it.
Your dad into it? Did he give you the guitar?
No, I suppose my folks, we bought it on a holiday in Spain when I was years earlier, like when I was only 7 or 8. It just sat in the corner of my room like a souvenir.
Wow.
And wasn't even sure it worked. You know?
Right.
I'd pick it up and I'd learn to play one chord, then the second chord would be too hard. I'd put it down again. And in the end, you know, you uncover the mystery of it and then it's magical.
Get to see you go as far as you've gone? Your father?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the last show he saw was 2010 at the Festival Hall. Okay. And that was a solo show, and I was able to sing, you know, the way I sing now often is on my own, and I plot a line through all the songs I've got. I'm lucky to have so many songs. I can tell a different story every night, depending. And that way I never feel like the well-known songs never seem like a sad ritual. They come up unexpectedly at me because the way I get to them is different every night. My mother is still with me, so my mother smuggled records into Liverpool in the early 50s when you couldn't get them. She would give seamen money to get jazz records that were unavailable. She worked in a record shop. I know, it sounds crazy.
Yeah.
But that's how difficult it was for people in England to hear the music they loved.
Right.
Whatever type of music you talk about, whether it's punk rock, rock and roll, my dad was originally a bebop trumpet player, and that was the, you know, supposedly crazy new music out of America in the late 40s, and you couldn't buy those records in England, so you had to find a way to get them. That's the story.
But Elvis, do you think that's why it became almost precious, more precious, that music? You know, when you look at the way Keith would talk about American blues, he cared about it more than Americans did.
I think that's absolutely right, because we were hearing these sort of secret messages, as we thought. And I think, well, depending on what generation you are, Keith's a little older than me, but those Slim Harpo, Howlin' Wolf records, they must have seemed... there was nothing like that in England. There was nothing connected up like that. And that was definitely true. I didn't know any rock and roll when I was a kid because my folks were listening to Sinatra and jazz. But my dad had to sing what was in the hit parade. And then the Beatles hit. And that was actually the first rock and roll revival. You know, for a while I thought George Harrison wrote Roll Over Beethoven. You know,
right.
It wasn't until I read the fine print. Oh, Chuck Berry, oh, I've heard of him.
Right.
And then you hear the records. And they'd go on about Elvis being their hero. I mean, Elvis by 1963 was singing It's Now or Never to a nice 9-year-old. That sounded like opera.
Yeah. Yeah.
It didn't sound like sexy. You know? And then when I heard those Sun records, oh, now I get it. You know, it took a while.
Right.
You don't have to hear everything in sequence. So, I mean, I think when people kind of get impatient with something I do, I go, well, give it a little while, because it's taken me a while to get
sure.
You know,
that was always like that with Bowie with me. I'm always like 2 albums behind.
You'd write him off, wouldn't you?
Yeah,
I remember even with the Beatles, when Sergeant Pepper came out, you know, and they're doing these vaudeville songs, and they've completely lost their minds now. That's it, they're over.
That's done.
And the next week, you know, I say in the book, when I was at school in Liverpool, 1971, the entire school took the day off to queue up round the Empire Theatre to buy tickets for the Rolling Stones. And I got there late, and I saw the length of the queue. And, you know, I was 16, self-righteous, you know, I went, Rolling Stones, yeah, they're past it.
Right.
And I went and used the money to go and buy a record instead of that. I'll get more out of the record. Of course, I missed the Rolling Stones playing Sticky Fingers. What an idiot. You know, at that time, I was convinced of the idea that, you know, because that wasn't the music for me, you know.
What record did you buy, do you remember?
Yeah, Volunteers by Jefferson Airplane.
Yeah, there you go.
I rest my mind. It's not a bad record, but not really.
No,
as good as... I did see Leon Russell. That way, you know, he came and scared the hell out of everybody with his top hat. And, you know, we didn't see so many shows in Liverpool. You know, they mostly came to the Liverpool Stadium, which was a boxing stadium. Hadn't always had the blood washed off the seats, you know, that kind of place. Or we'd have to get on the train early in the morning and go and buy tickets for the Manchester gigs. You know, they're 40 miles away, you know. So it was a little more difficult, even when I was a teenager, to hear the music that we loved.
Did your dad meet the Beatles?
He did. He was on the bill with the Beatles in 1963. He was on the Royal Command Performance, which was then a pretty big deal. It was a variety show, annual variety show for, you know, benevolent, fun retired artists. And everybody would be honored to be on it. They would have excerpts from West End shows like Broadway shows and jugglers and Paraguayan folk singers and Marlene Dietrich accompanied by Burt Bacharach.
Wow.
And that year's pop sensation, of course, were the Beatles. And my dad's, the band my dad sang with also appeared on it. And it would, you know, I was very excited at that age that my dad, not so much that he was going to sing for royalty, I could care less about that, but that he was going to be on the bill with the Beatles.
Did he care?
Autographs and... When I think about it, he was 35. It must have been have been tough for him to go up to these 22-year-old lads.
Yeah.
With his own autograph for my boy. Must have had everybody there trying to do that.
He got them for you?
On one sheet of paper. And he came home the next day, and I tried. In the book, I try to paint the picture. I try to be as cool as you can be when you're that age. Like, Dad, you know, did you meet the Queen Mother? You know, I try to ask him all these other questions, like, other than did you get the Beatles autograph? He obviously had a hangover. You know, he'd been out late after the show. Eventually reached into the jacket that was over the back of his chair and pulled out this perfect sheet of paper with all four signatures on one piece of paper, which was rare to get them all in one piece of paper. My autograph book, on the other hand, was half the size of that sheet of paper, so I cut round. Not quite accurately as well. The Beatles got a little clipped, you know, and then I pasted them in, and I have it still. It's in, if you buy the, you know, the ebook, because you know, people like to carry it around, that you get, I put a lot more images. There's like 200 more pictures in the ebook.
Right, that's awesome.
So all the little documents and pictures that I talk about in the story, you can actually see them, and that's one of them.
I still have the actual
autograph.
Oh, that's great.
And he took it every week to radio broadcasts, and it's got, you know, bands that are not so well known are like Freddie and the Dreamers, but Tom Jones and people who are still, you know, with us now.
Did all that background make it seem less daunting, like, to live an artistic life?
I don't know about the artistic life. I was able to see how music went in a split second from a workaday thing to something magical.
Uh-huh.
I would go over to my father to radio broadcasts and sit there in the stalls watching men read the paper and probably smoking cigarettes in those days. And then they'd go, okay, now. And the light had come on and then something would happen.
Right.
And because there was only 5 hours of recorded music on the BBC at that time, a day. So that was for every kind of music. So the bands would have to come in and play their songs live in order that their hits were heard by the public. So you'd get somebody like the Hollies, you know, with Graham Nash would come in, and I watched them come in carrying their own amplifiers. They'd probably driven overnight, real scruffy.
Awesome.
And then they'd go into the dressing room and reemerge when the broadcast was a lunchtime broadcast, and they'd be announced, and these guys would bounce out in their shiny Italian-style suits and sing Just One Look, and, you know, then it was real, you know, then it was like you'd seen him on TV.
When did you first meet McCartney? Because I know you collaborated with him.
I met him at a charity concert, a benefit concert for Capocheer in 1980. We were on the last ever Wings show. We were one of the opening acts for the very last Wings show, and so I met him then. And then we were in adjacent studios in 1982 when we were making Imperial Bedroom. He was making Tug of War in the next studio, which was very strange. You'd go up to the Rec Lounge and he'd be playing the Asteroids Machine or playing pool, you know. It took a while to get over that, you know.
Did you try to play it cool when you first met him, or did you just kind of fanboy out?
I'm from Liverpool, too. Yeah.
Paul's always kind of noted the things that, you know, he's always said, I'm not actually from Liverpool because my family is, but I was born in London, but I spent a lot of time there, so I'm kind of an adopted son. But he always picked up the things that were similar. His father was in a dance band, so I suppose we found a way to work together. When he invited me to write with him, that was some of the conversation that we have some things in common. Hey, we're both called Mac.
Mm.
Yeah? Right. My name is Mac Manus, really, not Costello. Yeah. Costello is an Irish name as well. It's not Italian. It's my great grandmother's name, but I picked it because it sounds easier to say.
Yeah, fun, sure.
You know, if you're Declan McManus, Declan, it sounds like somebody's going to sing some folk songs. You know, it's not really, it's not a sexy rock and roll singer name at all. You know,
ladies and gentlemen, Declan McManus.
Yeah, it's too hard to say.
When you're writing with somebody else, does it change the way that you write? I mean, does it change?
Yeah, because I mean, if you wrote all over their opinions, what would be the point of being in the room?
Yeah.
I mean, when I first came into work with Paul McCartney, I had a song called Veronica, which was actually a serious lyric. You know, it was about my grandmother, and she was sliding, or had been drifting, into what we now would call, you know, early stages of Alzheimer's. And it was, I didn't want to write you know, the sad, mournful song about it. I was wanting to write something bright. And so I was going to tell that story as well, and tell it with bright, kind of optimistic sounding music. And Paul just, you know, he saw what I was trying to do, and he helped me do that. He helped me. He looked at it as a craftsman job. He could make it better because he knows about the way, you know. And then the next songs we got into were a bit more of a dialogue where we would just get some sort of starting point, a turn of phrase, the usual ways you start songs. Somebody will say something. Oh, that's a title. And then we take it from there. And what's the story then? And then we'd throw it back and forward like some sort of tennis match or something.
What do you do when you're running with McCartney? If you have a lyric you like and he has a lyric he likes, like, you know, how do you go like, yeah, I think this might be better when it's a guy like that?
Well, I mean, he wouldn't be asking me if he didn't think my opinion was valid. So that was what I always bore in mind. You know, I wasn't going there as a 9-year-old Beatles fan club
right.
member. I was going there at 38, 39. I'd done a lot of things. I hadn't had anything like the hits he'd had, but he wouldn't have been asking me if he didn't want to know my opinion. And there was a little bit of tension to be had by our different points of view about music. I mean, sometimes we disagreed. Of course, we'd have to, you know. Sometimes when we were recording, because I tried to co-produce the tracks that we wrote with him for his album, and one day I said, you know, when you were, you know, I didn't want to say when you were in the Beatles, but on Revolver, say, Taxman, yeah. you know, yeah. bass, he played down the bass end, and then he'd play these little kind of high figures, and that's going to boom, doom, doom, bum, doo. You know, he'd hear all that. I said, why don't you throw a few of those little fills in, you know, because that's kind of your thing. People love that. And he went in and immediately did a pass of these lays, and then he said, yeah, now, he said, I've got to go and take this phone call. You erase the ones you don't need.
What?
And I'm sitting here with my finger on the red button, and I go, I now have to choose which of these things is going to be gone forever, because it's not like Pro Tools where it lives in...
You can't just save it, yeah.
Yeah, it's actually on tape and you're making space.
That's a lot of pressure.
Know, that's the great thing about when we started out, he started out 4-track recording or less. Mm. I started out 8-track recording. You had to make decisions. You couldn't defer the decision you had.
What's
to
the
commit.
Difference? I know nothing about musical recording.
Well, I mean, if you imagine the tape runs with 4 parallel or 8 parallel or 24 parallel channels. With a modern recording, we have almost an infinite amount of choices. So in a way, it can trick people into just refining. There's lots that's good about modern recording, but there's some of the records we love, you know, I mean, records like Little Richard or something like that that McCartney grew up on, they were just some people playing in a room.
Yeah.
You put
right.
it on and it went to wax or it went to 2-track tape. Everything you hear is that's what they were doing. There's no editing. Well, there's nothing.
When you go to Sun Records, it's just a little room.
I tell
you,
the room I made my Amish Truant is smaller than this room.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, when I was a teenager and I heard what we call Tamla, what you call Motown, Tamla Motown yeah. Records, right. I believed every record was made in a cathedral because right. it sounded so grand. And Levi Stubbs at a four top sounds like he's on the edge of a canyon. Mm. And the canyon is full of doom and, right. and like fate.
Yeah. yeah.
And he's there on the edge and he's going to leap off because some girl did him wrong.
Yeah.
And then that's what you feel about it too. I thought the records must be made in Notre Dame Cathedral or something. Then you get there and again, it's a room the size of this.
Do you feel like modern recordings lost some of the soul, or do you think that it's...
I don't know. I'm not trying to put myself in the mind of somebody now. I know somebody somewhere is in a room smaller than this.
Right.
Feeling something that is totally real for them,
right?
So I'm not gonna say, oh, of course I know that it's better now.
Like I apologize. He always tries to get people to go into a different mindset. We ask him every time, don't do that.
It's like Neil Young is like really going out and saying like the way that music is recorded now and the way we listen to it, it's really losing like the heart and soul.
That you can prove on a graph.
Yeah,
what Neil's saying is absolutely right.
Yeah,
I mean that you can prove that a CD doesn't sound as good as vinyl. That MP3 sounds a third as good as both of those things, but we all love the convenience of your phone having a library of music. So accept the fact that it's actually inferior quality.
Right.
It's like listening to a badly tuned AM radio. You can prove that,
right?
But it's we settle for something. People, you know, of all the way, each innovation that's come in with technology, they said, oh, that's going to finish it.
Right.
When radio first started in the 20s, they said that was going to end recording.
Right.
So nobody will buy records anymore because they can get it for free on the radio. Then guess what? It made bigger stars out of those people than ever before.
Right.
Then Talking Pictures did the same thing to radio for a while, and so it goes on. CD is better than vinyl because it's longer and you can't break it.
Right.
Have you ever actually thrown a CD at the wall and sees what happens? Yeah. It's not unbreakable. You know? Yeah.
So. I think the way kids listen is a little differently. I don't know if they sit around together like we did when we were younger and just sit around watching that turntable, listening to a new album.
Reading the jacket.
It just felt so heavy at the time. You
that's,
know?
That's our feeling. But, you know, they're all talking to one another. So the conversation that we used to have, or the relationship that we had with the printed word of the liner notes, if that's your experience, if you're that age where you read those liner notes over and over again, you could say that that's people talking and posting their thoughts about things. As they'd like, probably people like to think it's democratic. What of course is kind of also happening is that everybody thinks they're a Rolling Stone critic or such a critic, and they're actually writing these long essays. They're not really speaking from the heart. They're speaking for an audience, so they're performing too. But nevertheless, I think the fact that any kid can find, I had come to America the first time, 77. One of the things that I came home with was a cheap suitcase full of cheap records that I bought in secondhand stores, pawn shops. And these were whole albums by people that previously only had one song on.
Right.
Maybe some R&B compilation, I'd have a soul singer who, I can get the whole album and it's like 10 cents. Mm. So I would come with an empty suitcase after the first tour and my record collection just exploded. That you can do click, click, click on the internet, but you have to know where to look and what you're looking for.
Yeah.
It could be anything. It could be music from anywhere in the world.
But it's amazing if you tell a kid, here's one person, they could go listen to their entire thing over a weekend. Where we, you know, if you were going album by album, it would take forever to figure out who some of these people
are. I really don't go whole with the view, though, that younger people are listening less intently, because I know people who have the knowledge of music that is, you know, in volume much greater than I started with.
Oh, yeah.
I would argue that, obviously, you know, what I described at the beginning of our conversation, that one piece of music standing out, waiting all week to hear your favorite record played on a particular radio show, and you knowing it was only going to be heard, obviously made that a different kind of special. Mm-hmm. But I don't know that you can compare. It's not like and like.
Yeah.
The experience of the modern day is totally different. You'll have to go into the future to see how it shakes down, you know.
But it is odd when you run into kids that are like 19 years old and they know five decades of music. They know
five decades of musicians. People who are 19 years old who love James Taylor.
It's crazy.
To the exclusion of the people of their generation. Mm-hmm. They've for whatever reason, decided that it's all about, and maybe not even somebody as well known as James Taylor.
You know?
When I had a TV show over at Sundance, spectacle, you know, I got to share the stage and talk to various musicians, and we had people who were very, very well known, like Bruce Springsteen, kind enough to do it. But I also got to put some of my favorite songwriters on, who I assumed everybody had heard of. But say there's a songwriter called Jesse Winchester who had lived in Montreal, is from Memphis, and even friends of mine who were big music fans had never heard him perform before and were completely affected by his voice. And that was worth the whole process of doing that show, just that a few people heard him, because I'd loved his music for 40 years and I couldn't believe he wasn't well known.
I think, too, one of the most amazing things about that show is, and I'll ask you, because you've known so many songwriters, do you all kind of write in the same way, or does everybody have their unique way?
I think everybody has a different way of writing. Yeah. I mean, that's why you can't write exactly like somebody else. You can learn things from them, but you can't be the other person. When you start to sing, you might hear somebody in your head and say, oh, I'm singing just like, but it's not really coming out like that. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I came to understand in writing all of this down for a book is by making the mistakes on the way to faulty copies of other people's music, you end up with your own style.
Yeah.
That's what it is, isn't it? You know, Elvis Presley, what was that? He was doing a hillbilly song with an R&B beat. Rock and roll. Bang, there it is. You know, all the great music and innovations are some sort of collision, but there's like a laboratory experiment that goes wrong, you know, where where the, you know, the professor drinks the wrong potion and he turns into the monkey and the monkey turns into the professor. It's that, you know.
Yeah.
And then the question is, where does like influence and begin and end and copying? Like, what's the, like, where's the line between somebody being influenced by somebody and somebody just ripping somebody off?
Are you saying there's a blurred line between it or something? You think there's a blurred line between it? Is that what you're suggesting?
Yeah, that really was an asshole point to make. It was a non-point.
Elvis, what was your first impression of America when you came in 77?
I said, you know, I tried to put it down. My first impression was, wow, double beds, color television,
really?
hot and cold, hot and cold running water, you know, in a bathroom attached to your bedroom, you know, which wasn't our experience in the shabby hotels that we could afford on our first trip round to England, where just even getting a curly cheese sandwich at 1 a.m. was a negotiation, you know, let alone a drink, you know. We stayed in the unimaginable luxury of the Howard Johnsons in Mill Valley my first night in America, you know. We were living the high life.
That's it. We have to wrap about the best for you. Yeah, I guess we got to wrap up.
They have other stuff. Okay. Elvis Costello, obviously, the book is called Unfaithful Music and Disappearing Ink, and it's out now. And if you're here in New York, Tuesday is going to be at the Conversation with Roseanne Cash at
That's
BAM.
Going to be great. With Roseanne, a good friend and a wonderful writer, and somebody who heaven knows about the relationship of a writer and a recording artist and songwriter who has a dad in the business. She might rank me in that way.
Yeah.
You know? And, she knows about family and all of those things. I mean, wow. We're going to be in conversation at BAM that night.
And that's in Brooklyn. It's the Gilman Opera House in Brooklyn. That's next Tuesday. Tickets are $25 and for the event. And it's $45, and you get a pre-signed book by Elvis, which is really a great deal. That's awesome.
Yeah, these events have been really interesting because every conversation has been different. I get to share some of the images from the book while we're talking, depending on what the questions are. I might read a couple of lines from the book, and then people can hear the voice I'm saying it in.
Right.
You know, because there's an audio book for this. I did that, you know. It's like 18 and a half hours of me. That's really what you want.
Yeah.
No, it was a great experience to read it. It took me 8.5 days to actually record it. But obviously, when you say something out loud, it takes on a different emotion. Sure. So sometimes I do a little of that. Who knows? It might even be a bit of music.
You should try Twitter. I bet you'd be good at it.
I had difficulty getting down to the 140 characters.
Well, the book's getting rave reviews. I can't wait to take a look at this. We just got it, unfortunately, so we didn't get to read ahead of time.
That's what they all say.
I'm just lazy. I'm just a lazy porn addict.
Add it to the pile.
It's Unfaithful Music and Disappearing Ink.
Driving to work, you can have me tell it to you.
Right. Thank you very much, buddy.
What a pleasure. Thanks, Elvis Costello. Thanks, man.
Thank you.
All right, quick break. We'll be back. Back with Ron Bennington and Jim Norton and back Tom Papa.
Yeah, Elvis, big show. What a good show this was.
Elvis Costello was terrific.
He was really good.
We were all in the bathroom together. And
Don't
go there.
Don't.
All right.
Thank you.
He's an idol to a lot of people.
I would like to think these big superstars don't.
They don't.
They shit.
They
don't.
Didn't.
I would like to think they don't poop, actually.
They don't. Do.
It was the humming part that bothered me. The humming and the pooping.
Nice part.
Damn it.
Oh, what's up, man?
What's up, dude?
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Rob Dukes in studio. Nice, yes. Hey, Rob. Generation Kill.
Nice. And Ron Bennington, of course.
Good to see you, my friend.
What's going on, man?
We just had
Elvis. We had Elvis Costello in here.
I saw him walking through the hallway. Yeah.
You feel anything for Elvis Costello?
I teched for him once.
No kidding.
At the Viper Room, like fucking 12 years ago.
That's great.
Yeah.
Did you volunteer for it, or were you working there?
My buddy was doing the sound, and he says, "Hey, man, I need help." Okay. I lived across the street. I lived right there, across from Tower Records, in that apartment building.
I know that spot.
Yeah.
The best part of the interview was when Elvis Costello goes, a little song called Veronica. I'm like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think we all know that little song called Veronica. Like, we might not recognize the name of the song.
Did you like him when you saw him live or no?
I don't know. He's a legend. I'm not a huge fan. I don't own one record.
It wasn't your thing.
Not my thing.
Not your type of tune.
Mm-mm.
What was your thing growing up musically?
Queen.
Yeah. All right.
The Clash.
Okay.
And then, out of high school, started drinking real heavy, AC/DC, Metallica, nice. Suicidal Tendencies.
Right.
And then Pink Floyd happened. When I was a kid, that was like my first band was Pink Floyd. I stole the record from my mom. Mm.
And, The Wall?
Dark Side of the Moon.
I just went to a Roger Waters showing of this film. It's about The Wall or so. It's this updated thing he's doing on The Wall. It's,
right.
It was very... I like Roger Waters, but I didn't like the documentary. It was a little self-indulgent. Did you see it?
Oh, yeah. I didn't see it, but he's a douche.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
You're in the Gilmore side?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tom Papa.
Hey, nice to see you, man.
Yeah, it was a little self-indulgent, right? So, yeah, I tend to side with Gilmore as well.
Yeah.
From what I just
he just seems himself. Smarter and... The other guy seems so douchey, you know?
Yeah, it was all about him.
Yeah.
It's like, let The Wall go. Like, yeah, it's a great exactly. song. It's
the only thing that he owns from that era. They gave him The Wall, and they took everything else, Pink Floyd. They got the name, but they gave him The Wall, so that's all he really took out of it.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, so he owns The Wall. They can't do it.
Right.
And he can't go and, you know, do Wish You Were Here or any of the other albums.
Right.
Dark Side.
But he does Comfortably... That. Oh, Comfortably Dumb's off
no,
the wall.
He does those songs, but he does it. He owns the concept thing that you can tour. It got pretty ugly when they all. Yeah.
Well, they did
up.
One show, and then the guy before the keyboard player died, and you could see on stage at the end they did four songs in front of the Queen or whatever some shit in England, and you could see that like fucking get off of me, like we're done, like get away from me. They fucking hated it.
Hated
they
them.
Got it over with. And,
yeah. Was that before or after they did some an amazing show live? It was like some Stop Hunger Now or
it
something.
Was like Live Eight.
That was four songs. Yeah, that was the last
like Live
song.
Eight or something like that. Yeah. But, you know, it's terrible to be in a band. You know what I mean? You just fucking get so exhausted with each other after all those years.
Yeah,
you
fucking
just,
horrible.
Yeah, it's just something men can't do, to stay together for years and years and years.
Right.
Yeah.
Somebody has to have a vagina for people to never leave each other at all. So you get these guys, and like, you know, when they break up, you're supposed to pick sides with them, but you're just like, well, why can't I just like everybody? I wasn't in the van all those years.
That's a very smart statement, Ron Bennington.
Well,
Rolling Stones.
Yeah, Rolling Stones. I don't have to pick sides.
Thank you, Stones.
I don't have to say whether Robbie Robertson should have gotten the writing credit or not. I'm just going to enjoy the music.
Just going to enjoy everybody.
Yeah.
Why not?
Right.
That's why I felt so good about New Kids coming back.
You know what? There's one of those New Kids, though, that really pisses me off. I think it's Dougie. I'm not sure. But, you know, with these bands, they want to turn you into the divorce kid. Like, you have to pick who's right. I can't do it. Sorry. Right.
They're all wrong.
Yeah, they're all wrong.
I've been in bands. We're always wrong.
Yeah.
Everybody has their own shit.
Yeah. What happened in Exodus? Because that was a big gig for you.
You know, I just... It ran its course. And then, you know, they ended it really shitty. I'd been touring with them for almost 10 years. And they had gotten new management. And I could slowly feel the edge slipping away. And... you know how you always look back at shit and you go, oh, I should have just quit. That's what I was unhappy. I didn't like the new music they were writing. I thought it was shit. And I voiced my opinion. It turned everyone against me. Mm-hmm. And that was it.
Why was it shit?
I just, there's just no passion in it. It was just regurgitated shit that we'd just done and done and over and over and over again. And I didn't, there was no life to it. So I just kind of, you know, started to separate myself, and then you know, I was under a lot of pressure. I was getting married, I was moving, I had like a ton of shit going on, and they had fired me on my honeymoon like 3 days after my wedding.
Jeez.
Which really just sucked.
After 10
balls.
Years together, after
10 years, and honestly, I've never heard from any of them,
like, really.
And it just kind of left me a little angry, but I'm over it now. I'm fucking doing way better than I ever had before. I'm doing a record with Daryl from Run-DMC.
Sure. Nice.
And it turned out one song turned into an album.
I like that song. We had him in here.
Yeah, he got us DMC. He was awesome.
Yeah, thanks for that, by the way. He was a great talker. He was great for our radio show. So now you guys are doing a whole album.
Whole album.
That's
beautiful.
Great.
We have eight songs done. Three more to go, and then we're going to do like some hidden track shit for like we're going to do like a special vinyl release, and it's really cool because it's different than anything I've ever done before, and it's challenging as fuck to not be a shit rap metal band,
right?
And to
right.
kind of bring those two together, because I'm not really a metalhead; I'm more like a rock and roll kind.
And
of
he's
guy.
A rock guy, you know.
Yeah, he's always
he always was
everything.
A rock guy.
Yep.
Totally. Yeah, he has the knowledge. Yeah. As far as the rock and roll goes.
Yeah, he's awesome and fun to be around.
Loved him.
That's cool.
Loved the
guy. Just don't go on any second honeymoons.
No, that'll be it. It's all
over. I think we asked him one question, and an hour later, we're like, all right, well, thanks for coming. But that whole hour was amazing.
Yeah. I was going to bring him here with me, because I was like, oh, just come with me. And he's like, dude, I'm out of town. I was like, fuck. I wouldn't have had to talk.
Right.
Just him talking about being suicidal and stuff was really bizarre to hear DMC, in the height of all that fame, just wanting to fucking throw himself out a window.
How about the mom? Geez. That didn't know, who didn't know who? The mom didn't know that he was in Run-DMC.
Yeah. Oh, really?
And she was a huge fan of the band.
I had no idea.
No idea. For a long, long time. It was the mom, right?
I think so, right?
Jeez.
Do you know Rob or no?
It was a hell of a story.
She's not that smart.
I don't have fucking XM. I have to listen to fucking Pandora at work.
Yeah, I think it was the mom. She was a fan. And then
I
realized...
follow you guys on Twitter. That's the only way I know shit.
And they realized their son was the guy in Run-DMC, this band or whatever group that she loved.
Yeah.
Crazy. How did you meet Otto? You were close with Otto.
I was close with Otto. I met Otto like 20 years ago.
Oh, okay.
And we did the Telecrappies. I was one of the Telecrappies.
Wow, yes.
I was one of those.
No kidding.
I did a bunch of skits with Otto. Otto didn't drive. He didn't have a car.
No, we all know that.
So I used to pick him up and drive him to gigs. And when I first quit, I quit drinking like 22 years ago. So I was newly sober, and I was driving him to gigs. And I was like, yeah, man, I think I need to go to a psychiatrist because I'm fucking losing my mind. And he goes, yeah, I need one too. And he got on stage and started arguing with George about how crazy he was. And no one was laughing in the place but me. I'm in the back just fucking dying. And Otto, the whole ride home we were just quiet. And then we went to a diner and then he started doing Apocalypse Now fucking lines and we just started laughing again. And he was awesome. Love that guy.
Yeah, he tracked dog shit into my car one time. It was a brand new Saturn, and me and Florentine were doing a gig with him. And I used to pick him up. I used to live in Central Jersey, and I'd drive to Queens to get him, and then drive back down to pick. I didn't care, just to hang out with him. And he got in, and it stunk. And I'm like, "What the fuck, dude?" And I look, and it was literally the car was a month old, and he had tracked in about 3 pounds of dog shit. And Florentine's like, "I think you brought the whole log." It was a miserable fucking ride.
So we did a scene where we're in my car. I had this old piece of shit cop car, and I have George on my lap driving, and Otto's reaching over me. He's doing the head and stuff, and the camera's here, and Otto's driving, and he's yelling at fucking Otto. So just fucking brilliant. The whole day was just, it was awesome.
He's one of those guys frustrating, too, to like not see him get where he should have gotten.
Absolutely.
Like all these insane.
Yeah, like Rick Messina loved him, and all these guys loved him, and then just not to see him, not to go as far as every comedian knows he should have went.
Yeah.
The last couple of years, he was happy, though. When he met Trish, he just got happy. And he was okay, to be around. Mm-hmm. Whereas before that, I'd seen him in really bad places, you know. So
I used to drop him off to we used to do gigs and in Pennsylvania, and he would want to go get high. And I'm like, I'm not taking you. I'll drop you off, and you can do what you want, but I'm not sitting there waiting. I just couldn't do it. It was too enabling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's frustrating, though.
Yeah, I loved it. I miss him all the time. I think about him. I have a shirt that I used to wear on stage. It was pictured George, and it said cunt.
Yeah.
And it looked like the Obama hope thing.
Sure.
And I wore that for like a year on tour. And he used to call me, dude, I saw a picture of you on stage with a shirt.
That's pretty cool. Yeah,
it's great.
He got it all together at the end of his life.
Yeah, he did.
I remember the days at WNEW, he would come in, he would kill he was killing. And a minute into killing, he would just leave in the middle of his appearance and just run out. Like, where's he going?
Oh, really?
It was the strangest thing.
Do you remember when he did Stern and then he left and then he called in?
No.
Flipping out?
No, what happened?
That one I don't know.
He did a Stern appearance and he was great, but he felt that he wasn't. And
he went home,
he called in and started like just freaking out, like just really upset, and like and then hung up the phone. And they're like,
he never had a bad appearance, but there were days he would run out, literally run out in the middle. I'm like, wait, where's he going? This is going great. We turned this interview into a Otto and George interview through Rob Dukes.
Yeah.
Well, he had his stories too were just fucking amazing. How long he had been doing that shit on the streets and all, and when I did the Unmasked with him, I didn't let him bring George in, right? I'm like, no, I want to talk to you. And he's like, well, you know, I'll bring George. And I'm like, but I'd rather talk to you and hear the story. You don't have to be funny. And then that day he shows up. He's got George with him, you know. I go, well, let's just sit him here for a while. And then we sat down for an hour, and the fucking stories were amazing.
Yeah.
Just street performing stories. And it was like the history of this fucking city. He was like in every part of like the modern times of comedy in the city. It was amazing.
Yeah, I always love that too. Like, I always thought he's just as funny without George. When you talk to him, yeah, to be in the car with him.
Oh yeah,
I mean absolutely. The act he had to
the
do with George.
The fucking diner was the best. Just sitting down at a Greek diner was my favorite.
But you're right about movies and stuff. I mean, you could get so in deep. It was just great.
We used to Full Metal Jacket it all the time. That was like our favorite movie that we used to talk about. Yeah, fucking.
When he died, Trish gave me his copy of Clockwork Orange and a couple of other, like Freebie and the Bean. And
a couple of those. Great.
He liked these on a fucking video VHS cassette. She gave me Freebie the Bean and some other movie that he loved. There was like two or three.
I think he saw every movie that was made in the 70s.
Yeah.
Like you could not bring up whatever, you know, I guess that was when he discovered movies, but you couldn't bring up any movie, no matter how obscure, that he didn't know.
Well, that's because he also he never like worked a day job,
ever.
So he had nothing but a lot of time. Like,
yeah,
to watch movies.
Yeah, and he did see everything. He turned me on to a film called Little Murders. Did you ever see that?
Alan Arkin.
Alan Arkin and Gardenia and Elliot Gould. It was really funny, and you know, no one I know has seen that except for him. And he turned me on to it.
My friend Craig Cifola has actually a George in his house.
Is that right?
Yeah, Otto gave him one.
Which one?
Just one of the ones he had around. He gave him one.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Arno Cop. Who's Craig Cifola?
Chris Fuller did all the DVDs with him. He did the Telecrappies, did a bunch of stuff with Otto, did all his audio CDs for a couple of years.
Yeah.
So Craig is he does a lot of work with
him. And Copperfield has one, obviously,
yes,
in his museum.
Yeah.
Yeah, that video was pretty chilling, watching him
go see
George in Copperfield's house.
And what did he say? You're going to be safe here or something.
Yeah, he was really...
He was moved. He's like, George, all right, George is going to be safe here, or something like
that. Yeah, he knew Copperfield put him in a good place.
Yeah.
That made me like Copperfield. The fact that he liked Otto so much. I'm like, he can't be all bad.
Otto told me he hired him just to come to his house and perform for him and his, like, in like three people.
Yeah, Claudia Schiffer, I think. Claudia Schiffer might have got him as a surprise for David, I think, for his birthday or something.
He's a huge fan.
Yeah, he really was.
Huge fan.
Yeah, and he's way more interesting than me. So that's like better the interview than I'm here.
No. So you are you going to tour with DMC?
Well,
with the Generation Kill stuff,
we're going to do some stuff. We're you know, the album's going to come out in May or like May June next year. So we might do some festivals and I don't really think I could tour like I used to. Only because I started building hot. I moved to Phoenix and I started building hot rods, and that's really.
How do you get into that? How do you decide one day I'm going to go and build hot rods?
Well, I always did it. I just didn't have a lot of time because I was touring.
Yeah.
And now that I have the, you know, time, and so I just got to restore old Volkswagens that's my job.
Yeah,
I work at this place in Phoenix called Doug's Bugs. And
nice.
I do all Volkswagens, buses, Beetles.
I have a 67 Beetle.
I just restored a 56.
Really?
I did a 67 that sold for like $35,000 like 2 months ago.
Wow.
How hard is it to find the buses? My friend had one of those VW
vans.
Even a shitty one are really, really expensive now. You can pay $10,000 for a rusted out shit box and then spend $20,000 restoring it, but then it's worth $200,000.
That was our shitty car
growing
up. Literally
$200,000 for a bus.
We had a Volkswagen bus. And then my mom and dad took the seats out so they could get more kids in there.
Yeah.
Of all the cars I had, I'm saying I had right now, if I had them all, they'd be worth like $2-3 million.
Jesus.
The cars I had. I had a Goat, I had Le Mans, I had a Chevelle. Yeah. I had two Chevelles.
What are you doing with the hot rods?
All those are good.
I have a 62 Chevy.
Are you selling them to people?
No, I'm kind of restoring them and then I get sell them. Yeah.
Yeah.
Basically, I have a 62 Chevy. I put a LS1 motor in it.
That's a smart move.
I airbagged it.
I don't know.
It's a Corvette motor.
I'm guessing that's a smart move. I have no idea. Truck.
Yeah, just so I'm doing. I hang out with a car club. Roger Moret from Agnostic Front has a car club called the Rumblers out in Arizona, and I hang out with these guys called the Low Lives too.
How bad do you want to go to Cuba and get your hands on some of those fucking cars?
They're all four door though. Sucks.
Yeah.
I was in a car club. Guys called me the cruiser.
Should have called you the dork.
But we look at all those old cars like and go, wow. But the locals down there are like, fuck that. I'll junk my car tomorrow to get a new one.
Yeah.
They've
yeah.
had it.
Yeah.
They want new cars.
Yeah. There's, you know, they have.
It's not as romanticized as that.
They don't even have parts. They got to make them. They make them from scratch.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
their brakes, the big asbestos pile, and they reach in and grab it and, you know.
So. Figure it out to get those cars to continue.
Yeah, you're right.
On.
They will
it's
be
hard
they,
to find original they, parts now, though.
No, they
for
don't.
Those.
For the most part, they don't give a fuck like we do.
Yeah.
They want a brand new ride.
Yeah. Right.
And they cannot wait.
Leno uses for the 3D first printer to make just like, if he had to make like something like a mirror for some weird. Old car, he'll actually use a 3D printer to make the other one if it's an impossibility to get it.
Isn't it funny to see him do that car show and see him actually happy? You know what I mean? When you watch
so
that
happy.
Show, he is so enthusiastic. He's fucking at the top of his game.
Yep.
You know, like he's finally doing what he wanted to do.
Doesn't care who's watching.
Yeah, he doesn't give a shit. The cars are great. Every episode I ever watch, I'm like, this is fucking fantastic.
The show is good.
Yeah, it's
no
amazing.
More, it's really more Doritos commercials.
He's in his element.
He doesn't have to bring a movie star out and just try to fucking
believe
kill,
a fuck.
Yeah, kill 12 minutes with him.
Right.
He's brought me up to that garage. I've gone through that
have
garage.
You?
It's insane.
I want to go to it. It's an airplane hangar, right?
It's like three of them. It's like three airplane hangars.
How many cars are there?
Filled. Oh. Hundreds.
Hundreds.
Cars.
You should
bikes.
Have keyed all of them.
I did. I wrote Conan in the back of
one
of them.
No,
it's amazing.
How does the insurance...
He brought my father up and stuff. He was super cool.
Oh, wow. How does the insurance work on that if you have hundreds of cars? Do you know? Because you got
know.
A few, Rob?
No idea.
Some kind of big umbrella policy.
Yeah, yes. He's able to handle it because he's
I know,
packed a
I
few bucks
that,
away.
But,
yeah.
But almost every car on that show... looks better than anything that's brand new today. It doesn't matter where
it's
you
amazing.
Pick up them, you're like, that's beautiful.
Well, the least expensive car he has is like $250,000.
Yeah.
And that's like a 56 Buick that he restored, and it's worth that much. So everything else is like way more than that.
Do you know
that,
what his favorite one is out of the hundreds?
The Buick, the 56
Definitely
Buick.
Definitely the Buick?
He bought it for $300.
Come on.
And it's worth $270,000 right now. That was on the that was one of the episodes I watched the other night. I love that show.
And he said it's definitely his favorite.
I never liked him for so long because of Bill Hicks, and now I like him again.
Wait, what was the Bill Hicks angle? I love Bill Hicks.
Bill Hicks was like, "Fuck Leno, you got to do fucking Doritos commercials and fucking sell out to the men. You need more money. You got the fucking Tonight Show, and you got to do that shit. You fucking piece of shit." And he goes off on him for, and then he does like a. Bullet gun to the head.
Yeah.
And then,
But that was back then when there was a thing like called selling out.
Yeah.
Now it's a
no. They don't. Bill Hicks will be doing Doritos commercials right now for sure.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But, you know, Leno is the one that got Hicks on Letterman, too.
Yeah.
So
he
had to really go a long way before he got pissed over that.
No, but it is amazing. Like, even the design of like just regular cars back then, there was different colors and shapes, and now everything's just bland.
I hate it.
It's just gray boxes.
Dull,
right? I know.
Everything sucks.
Well,
there's no
important.
Color even.
Yeah.
Even the
safety
good cars
and comfort.
Suck.
Yeah. Everything's about comfort inside. Oh, what a nice ride.
It's great, though, when you take the Beetle out. Everybody stops you. It's like being in a parade. Everybody wants to tell you the story. I had that in high school. We used to commute with that. We went cross country in that.
I drive a Baja. I have a 70 Baja lifted.
Nice.
Big ass tires on it. Bigger motor. Lights on it everywhere. Roll cage. And I drive that to work every day.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
How many people are waving as you're
I get this every day.
Just
pointing
at
it.
That's awesome.
That's the one I sold that to finance the truck. Because I found that I found that and it was
what
cool.
did you get for
oh, that's great.
I got $5,000 for that. It was a piece of shit.
Really?
66 stock Beetle.
Stock Beetle. No, nothing was changed. It had a 1600 motor in it, not the 13, but it was no rust. It was.
Automatic?
No.
I like a good automatic.
They don't make automatics.
Oh, they don't?
They make an auto stick. It was a piece of shit.
Oh, I like a good automatic. I don't know how to drive a stick. I'm busy. I'm texting. I'm fucking jerking off whatever girl's next to me.
I miss driving a stick.
It's hard getting it into first sometimes.
Like the stick.
But
I've never done it. I know I did it once. I stole my friend Dean's
let me drive his, I didn't steal, I stole my grandmother's car, but he let me, my buddy Dean let me drive his Volkswagen. It was fun.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
We were stoned. I didn't know how to do it.
Yeah, I go in the desert. I have like a Baja and I go out in the desert and we just fucking beat the living fuck out of him.
That's great.
Drop some acid.
Did you grow up out there?
Listen, no, I'm from New Jersey.
You just found yourself in Phoenix?
I moved there a year and a half ago. I'm in 22 years sober.
Wow.
But I used to drop a lot of acid.
You want acid?
Yeah. No, not anymore.
No, I mean you used to.
Yeah.
You thought you said you want some.
Yeah. You want, no, you want acid? No, thanks. I'm good.
It's a weird show.
Yeah, I moved out there to build cars. I wanted to build cars in my off time. And then I got fired the day I moved there. No. Which is, it was just weird. Here's how me and DMC met. At the very last Exodus concert I played, I was walking through catering back to the bus to go watch the New York Rangers play in the playoffs. And I ran into Daryl and I said, "Hey, man, you're awesome." He's like, "Oh, cool." And I walked away. That was it. And then the next day, next morning, I ran into him at the airport, sitting at my gate. And he was going to New York. I was going to New York. I was like, "Oh, hey, man. Oh, yeah, here's a CD of my band." And he called me a week later.
Jesus.
And said, "Dude, I love this album. It's fucking brilliant." He had this one song, Carney Love, that I loved. That's why I drive to work every day.
That's great.
So and he called me a week later and said, "Let's write a song together." So we wrote that song, Lot Lizard. And then it turned into an album. I came out here, we recorded it.
That's the coolest.
And then we just became buddies because he's sober too. And we just had so much to talk about and so much in common. And it was just kind of, all right, cool.
That's pretty cool. Yeah.
I never have those meetings in airports. I go, "Hi, I'm a big fan." And they go, "I'm on the phone." All right, I'll go away.
What could have been?
But I don't see a phone.
Yeah, exactly.
Where's the phone at?
Exactly. Both of your hands are visible and they're empty.
There's no earpiece.
Yeah, your ears are empty and you actually just look like you want to be talked to. I have to leave. I have to go to the airport.
Where are you going?
I'm flying to North Carolina right now.
Wow. Where are you playing?
The Comedy Zone.
Oh, wow. That's a good
this
club.
This place is great.
Yes, Charlotte?
Hey, you got to bring up the Panthers. They're undefeated.
First thing I'm going to do when I go out there, Panthers jersey.
Yeah.
Get them on your side.
Dressed as a cat.
Where are you flying out of, Newark?
I don't know.
Oh.
Yes. Terminal A.
I hope you run into somebody big at the airport.
Yeah.
What other big star is going from Newark to Charlotte today?
Cam Newton.
Cam Newton.
Mm-hmm.
They have it.
They have it.
With that, the nature boy.
Let's get out of here. Rob, yeah, man, come back and see us. Rob Absolutely. Dukes. It's Rob underscore nice Dukes on Twitter. Yeah, I see a lot of great pictures of the cars. So.
And Generation Kill.
Of course.
Whenever your record's coming out.
In May, you said, right?
I brought a track for you guys to play at the end. I gave it to Roland.
Really? Nice.
We could do that.
It's never been played before. We just finished it like a week
ago. Exclusive.
Opie
Radio. Exclusive.
What was the bit? Smasher. What was it called?
Smasher Trash.
Smasher Trash. Yeah. You could do a little Smasher. No,
there you go. Do it, man.
No. Well, what's the name of the song?
Underneath the Skin.
Underneath the Skin by Generation Kill. We're going to do that. Tommy?
I'm going to Glenside, Pennsylvania, the Keswick Theater next Friday, and then Wilmington, Delaware right after that. TomPapa.com for all your ticket needs and painter caps and buttons and things.
Always a pleasure to see Tom Papa. Ron Bennington does more radio today at noon on Raw Dog.
Yeah, and then I'm going out with Jenny Hutt and try to have lunch with her and figure out everything that's going on. She's a little upset about some of the things I said earlier. So I'll let you know how that's
going. Can we watch it on Periscope?
Yeah, we'll be on Periscope the whole time. It's really, really good. It's really good.
And Deep Tracks. I want to check this
Saturday,
out.
GPS is the name of the show, and this is New York City in the 70s, 3 o'clock on
Beautiful.
Saturday.
Nice. All right. Generation Kill as we leave. Rob Dukes, thank you, buddy.
Thank you, guys. Man.